Welcome back to Bobcat Stadium, the addition of the Northside Complex, adding 14,000 seats. There won't be many empty tonight, 32,000 capacity. Red Raiders and Bobcats ready to battle here in this Lone Star State Showdown. Big 12 against the WAC. Warm weather. You expect that this time of the year in this part of the country, but a brisk wind has picked up from time to time as well. Forecast sunny, and then we'll move into the evening hours. Big game for this program and for Texas State, as they have already made a statement with a road win at Houston. Now a chance to do that on the home turf.
Well, last year they didn't have very much success when they opened up against the FBS schools, and this year is completely different. They went into Houston, a situation where they were the extreme underdog, and got out of there with a win. But not only just a win, they dominated in the win, holding Houston to 1-13 on third down.
Just 13 yards rushing, and that is something they're obviously very excited about. This is a great setting here, newly renovated, we mentioned, and they love their football. The lead up to the game, you can see the enthusiasm from the fans and the players as well. Tommy Tuberville, third season. He has had quite a career, 17th overall, 11 bowl trips, 7 bowl wins. He's one of 5 coaches to win a bowl game at 3 different schools. Of course, everybody remembers that 13-0 Auburn team. And on the other side, Dennis Francione, second year of a second stint as head coach at this school, previously when they were Southwest Texas State. 9 career conference titles, so well respected for what he has brought to college football as well.
I mean, you're looking at 2 icons of the sport. I mean, these guys have coached at a lot of major places, and I think it's great when you have programs such as these to be able to get coaches like this, because it allows that program to grow to the next level.
And kicking it off for Texas State will be Jason Dan. They have some concerns with their kicking game. He's a sophomore from Dallas. Will Johnson is dealing with a nagging groin injury. He's their kickoff specialist, their place kicker, and their punter. And they might have to tag team because of that injury. Dan, a Nebraska transfer, has it teed up. And Texas Tech with the deep men, Marquez. Or actually, it is Marquez and McRoy back there. And it will be Marquez across the 25 and upended at the 27-yard line.
Number 4, Bradley Marquez on the return.
Texas Tech last week, 47 times they put it in the air, 46 runs. Great balance. They want to throw it, though, and get about 300 yards per game. That's their goal. But they know that that run game can't control clock, and we'll see how that works into play as the season progresses.
Well, and that's the whole thing about spread. It's not always about the pass. It's so much more now in these days with the run, and how they use it to balance it out, because teams were just teeing off on them, and they definitely have a strong run attack based on the game last week.
Seth Doege last week, 199 yards in the win against Northwestern State. Davey O'Brien, Maxwell, Walter Camp Award candidate will start this series, the initial series from the 27. Deep ball down the middle of the field, and some contact, and a flag is thrown. He was looking for Javon Bell, the junior from Jacksonville, and Mager, the corner, draped all over.
That's one of those situations, as the receiver stopped to go up for the ball, the DB went through him before the ball got there. And that's the kind of situation that you will get a flag on every time.
Scott Novak, our lead referee here. Here's a look.
You can see right there, as the receiver stops, he runs right into him. And when that happens, that's definitely going to be called a pass interference. As a DB, you have to have control. I call it, you have to be able to feel the shoulder without touching the shoulder.
Look at Mager, a sophomore from the Lone Star State, challenged on that play right at the get-go from the 42-yard line now. Doege looking underneath, nothing there. A half roll to the left, and he fires incomplete through the hands of his tight end, Jace Amaro. Let's look at the Red Raiders offensively, and they have so many weapons. When you talk about up front, though, the left tackle, LaAdrian Waddle, is an all-Big 12 guy. He's a Lombardi and Outland Trophy candidate. He is a brick wall on that left side. And many options in the passing game. Eric Stevens Jr., the running back, grueling rehab, has battled back from a knee injury. Not quite 100%, but still very good at running back. Doege incomplete, again looking Amaro's way, and now it's 3rd and 10 coming up for the Red Raiders. Mager over there.
Looked a little confusion over there. Two receivers kind of stopped in the same area. Not sure who was supposed to get the ball, as you see right there. One goes up, and you have two people there. It looked like a mix-up in routes. Beginning of the game, you're going to see a little of this.
They love Deggy's accuracy. Smart kid. Throws the deep ball well. We saw that on the first play of the game. He might have to do it here. Has time. Far side of the field. Catch is made near the stick by Bell. Let's see where they mark it. Maybe a little bit shy. They mark him out at the 49. That is a yard short of the first down. And now fourth and one coming up.
Precise throw to the sideline from the far hash. You're able to drop back. Deggy zips that ball over there. Look at the throw. Great accuracy like we talked about in the open. To put that ball there on the sideline where only his receiver can get it. Now they got fourth and short.
And they are not hesitating. Tuberville and Texas Tech going for it. Fourth and one at the 49. They'll run it. Stevens end around and a fumble. And the Bobcats have it at the 45-yard line. It's picked up by David Mayo, the middle linebacker.
The reason this play broke down was the exchange. You're going to see they're trying to do a double reverse. And when the ball was pitched by Eric Stevens Jr., he did not pitch it high enough to where his receiver, Javon Bell, can get it. Awesome job by David Mayo getting on that ball. If he had scooped it up, he was walking into the end zone.
As the underdog, you need to have some breaks go your way. They were 36-point underdogs at Houston last week, and a great start as Mayo is at the right spot, right time. The junior from Oregon, short field for Rutherford and company. Quarterback going to use his legs. He's very good at it. Down to the Red Raiders 39-yard line, a pickup of seven. Sean Rutherford, you saw his ability in the open field. He's a dual threat guy, returning starter, tough, competitive. He had a career high 18 completions last week. That's not his real strength as you look at the numbers, though. His ability to run the football is what concerns teams.
And that's very dangerous to defenses. And Art Kaufman, new defense coordinator, is going to have to find a way to pin him in and make him throw the ball and not use his legs so much.
Second and four from the 39. Handoff running to the right side. They get into the hands of Terrence Franks and a short gain of a couple, third down and short coming up. We're going to see Franks and also Marcus Curry as that tackle was made by Brandon Jackson the end. Here's the Texas State offense. It's a team that is young in the middle. They have a sophomore, redshirt freshman, Tuttle Freeman and Crawford there. Curry is the guy that's coming off a career high, 131 against Houston last week, but we'll also see Franks at that spot in the order. And we mentioned Harper, look for him, big target at 6'5" at tight end. Here's a keeper now. On the edge, it's Rutherford, and he has a first down inside the 30-yard line. The option game, so key to what they want to do in offense.
Well, and this is what he did last week against Houston as well. And it's effective because he is so dangerous with this run option. Defenses have to play him honest. And you're seeing right there, he's just reading and taking what the defense gives him. And that's what's so important about when you run an option attack. The quarterback has to be smart enough to know when to place the ball in and when to take it out and keep it.
Cornelius Douglas on the stop. Rutherford hands it straight ahead. It's Franks, and he's inside the 25. Give him three on that carry. It is a option game out of the spread, but they'll go with multiple formations, and a Bobcat is down. That's the center, Matt Freeman.
Second down, seven.
One of those situations. You don't want to lose your key center that's played his way into it. You're looking at a redshirt freshman, 6'2", 279. But when you run this type of option, you need guys like this that can move quickly and to have a young guy. You don't want to lose a young guy right now. This is a program that was FCS and now they're FBS. So they're trying to build that depth. And that's what they talked about and our coaches called getting that depth so that they can compete on a weekly basis.
They will bring in another tight end here, David Lewis, facing a second and seven. You talked to Coach Francione. He said, we do run option. It's more of the pistol variety, though. It's not the traditional triple option you see. Here they come out with a different look. The gun, and they put a running back in motion in Franks. Rutherford over the middle, and it's intercepted right into the hands of Texas Tech's Cody Davis, and he's trying to take it the distance. Davis is gone. Touchdown, Texas Tech.
Pass is intercepted. Number 16, Cody Davis. Touchdown, Red Raiders.
What a play. Sean Rutherford is not really known for his passing, and you see why. As he's trying to get it to his tight end, Chase Harper there, he just floats it up, doesn't see the defender there. Cody Davis, the leader of this defense, he has 37 starts, and this is why. The guy understands when the offensive set comes out, where the quarterback is trying to go with the ball, put himself in the right position to get that turnover and to get the first points on the board.
The preseason all Big 12 safety, their clear-cut leader, right place, right time. And Texas Tech gets on the board thanks to their defense. And that's something they're going to hang their hat on a little bit more this year. It's been a much maligned D over the last few seasons. Ryan busted in for the extra point. And it's 7-0 Red Raiders.
I mean, that's a huge play right there. You look at what happened. Texas Tech turned the ball over, going for it on fourth down. And to have that situation, get a touchdown, that's huge.
Tommy Tuberville said number 16 right there, Cody Davis, had his best game of his career last week in the Red Raiders win. Well, maybe it's this week. An 88-yard pick six to put the Red Raiders on the board. Their defense playing well first 2 weeks of the season, and they'll kick it away now. And he had a clear sailing down that sideline.
Rutherford didn't see the backside safety coming. And as a backside safety, that's the smart thing you're supposed to do. And Coach Trumbull talked about that. Cody Davis really has a knowledge of the game, and he understands when offensive plays start to break down, he knows exactly what the quarterback's trying to do.
Texas State had something cooking there. They were moving the ball effectively with Rutherford in that option game.
Well, and that's what's frustrating, I think, for Texas State fans, is to get a turnover on your side of the field and to be able to be driving down to get possible points, and then you end up giving up seven. I mean, that's huge. You don't want to start the game out that way.
There's a celebration penalty after that Davis return, so they back up the kickoff to the 20-yard line now. And Kramer Fife, the sophomore from Austin, their kickoff specialist, will kick it from there. Should afford Texas State. Excellent field position, but it takes a crazy hop, and that's a free ball at the 42. And there is a scrum for it at the 40-yard line. It took a backwards hop, and the Red Raiders say they have it.
Wow. The up backs have to be more alert to see that the ball was kicked very high. And as an up back, you're never supposed to go backwards for the ball, but if that ball floats up, you have to be looking for it to make the call.
Texas Tech football, a tough turn of events for Texas State. The kickoff from the 20, it might have confused some people.
I think the guys just, like I said, the upbacks did not pay attention. And when you look at the returners, you got to come up to it. The reason they didn't charge it because the ball died so quickly. We talked about the wind earlier, and that ball got caught up in the wind, and they misjudged it.
Kicking into the wind, and J.J. Gaines right there was on the spot for the recovery. The freshman from Irving, Texas, and Texas Tech now at the 40-yard line starting their first series on offense, their second series on offense after getting that pick six. Deggy in a much better spot this time. Kenny Williams will go in motion. Far side. And the catch is made by Jakeem Grant, a redshirt freshman out of Mesquite, Texas.
To number 11,
and that's
Jakeem Grant.
A 9-yard pickup to the 31.
Second down short.
Three receiver look, play fake. Deggy, Grant again. First down, Red Raiders to the 18. They are so effective in so many ways, they really spread you out.
Oh my goodness, you're looking at the precise throw. Deggy rolls to the right, he has Grant scraping on the drag, puts the ball right in his hands.
Darryl Morris on the tackle, no huddle. They try to pick up the pace here and a flag is thrown as that ball was bounced back to Deggy. Procedure the call against Texas Tech. Deggy, we talked about his being up for national honors, and Tommy Tuberville loves his game management as well. That he earned his degree in May 2011. He's after his master's in exercise science. Led the NCAA last year with 33 completions, and in this offense, he's got a lot of weapons to work with. On first and 15 now for the end zone, and it's caught by Darren Moore. Touchdown Tech.
Pass complete for number 14, Darren Moore. A touchdown, Texas Tech.
Right there, you're seeing the mismatch. Darren Moore, 6'4", 216 senior. Coach Franchione said they're worried about the speed and size of these outside receivers, and you can see why. The ball's put up there. DB had no chance. Greg Mager tried to go over the top, but when you have 6'5 and you're only 5'11, that battle gets lost.
Moore missed the opener due to a team suspension. Glad to have him back. He really stretches out the defense as Buston adds the extra point. A pick six and then a big pass play from Deggy to Moore. And just like that, the visitors up by two touchdowns.
Not the start Franchione wanted to see opening this brand new stadium. And when you look at it, Tuberville is very excited. What a good way to start on the road.
14-0, Texas Tech. Moore finds the end. Darren Moore with a touchdown reception. He had 12 catches for 221 yards last year in the season opener against Texas State. As you look at Tommy Tuberville's team in less than a minute, 14 points. The defense steps up, and then the big play from the offense with a short field. After recovering the kickoff, Kramer Fife, the kickoff specialist, and here's Isaiah Battle out of the end zone for Texas State. Flag is thrown, and he goes down at the 27-yard line. Tackle made by Derek Mays.
Isaiah Battle on the return.
Holding on the Bobcats, and they will back them up. Not the start Dennis Franchione envisioned, as his team will be backed up inside the 10 now. Oh, the interception return started things.
Yeah, you can see right there Cody Davis jumping all over that ball, reading the quarterback, looking for his eyes, taking it to house 88 yards, and then you're seeing the kickoff, just a error by the special teams, and then it led to this touchdown right here. Again by the big guy Darren Moore going over the top.
So much anticipation for Texas State, but Texas Tech has really answered the bell here at the outset. Here's the option game, and they get it to the edge. Tim Gay coming into the game. The third running back, redshirt freshman from Houston, with a nice gain and a first down out to the 27-yard line. Texas Tech and Tuberville last year, so uncharacteristic. They've been to 11 straight bowl games prior to that 5-7 year last year. First losing season in 16 years. He only knows success as well, as they expect to go to postseason play year in and year out. It was a tough year.
It's definitely a tough year, and they're hoping to rebound, and it's looking good so far the first two games.
Rutherford on the keeper. And Texas Tech ready. Good play recognition that time by Terrence Bullitt, the Sam linebacker, and also Will Smith, the middle linebacker.
First down.
The Red Raiders defense, we've talked about Davis. Here's how they look up front. Kerry Hyder's been a star. He's a returning starter. Breakthrough in that opening game. Smith could be Big 12 newcomer of the year. He's everywhere. And, of course, Davis, team leader, 38th straight start. Got good corner guys as well. This looks like a much improved D in the scheme. We'll get into that as well. Rutherford going deep now. He wants Battle, and he overshoots him near the midfield stripe.
That was miscommunication again on that play. Battle wasn't paying attention as he's watching his quarterback. Rutherford wanted to throw that fade outside the numbers. It was one-on-one. They got the covers they wanted, but they didn't capitalize. And that's one of the things Franchione told us during the week, that they feel that they could take a chance on the outside corners, but that was a chance that they had that they squandered away.
Now it's second and 10. It's a team that is a run-first-oriented offense. Franks, Gay, and Battle. You see them in the backfield with Rutherford right now from the 23. Rutherford keeps, evades one defender, and then goes down after a yard gain at the 24. Rutherford, Red Raiders swarming, and that's the thing. They call themselves the chain gang, and that's the motto that they're trying to live up to this year.
Well, you talked about how many yards they gave up last year. Last in the FBS, and as a defensive player, you got to take pride in what you do. If your offense is going out there putting points on the board and moving the ball up and down the field, as a defense, you have to do your job by stopping the opposing offense and getting off the field. They've been through four different defensive coordinators in 4 years, and Art Kaufman feels that he can get these guys shaped up and ready to go to where that won't happen anymore.
They say links on a chain hold up under pressure, and they'll be facing some tough offenses in the Big 12 this year. Third and long now. Rutherford rolling left, throws off his back foot. He just got rid of the football. And there's the pressure from the front four. Leon Mackey was in there as there's some pushing and shoving going on.
That was a smart play by Rutherford. Nothing was there. He couldn't get out. And then he threw the ball away. And you're seeing right there, there's a scuffle going on. There's a new rule. Helmet off, you have to come out the game for a play. But you can see the pressure. There's nowhere for Rutherford to go, so he just throws the ball away. The smart thing to do.
So the offense sputters again, and the Red Raiders looking for some field position as Franchione talks to his senior quarterback. We may see junior Tyler Arndt the start of the year, they planned on playing both guys, but Rutherford played so well last week.
They got behind the ball a little bit right now, and that could spur a change if it continues down this road.
Zach Robinson to punt it away from the 15 for Texas State. Zuzulak lets it hit at the 35. A flag is thrown. The punter roughed up, it appears, and Zuzulak goes down at the 24. There's a break that they need badly here at the 8:04 mark.
You have to be smart when your defense is playing well. And right here, you're going to see the situation. Defender comes in there and dives for something he has no chance of making a block for. Not at all. And he does something like that. You can see Tumberville's talking to him right now. Son, you got to be smarter than that.
Chris Nuttall, the sophomore from College Station, Texas, running in to the punter. And they're going to say this was a run-in, not a rough of the punter. Would not be good enough to pick up the first down, only a 5-yard penalty. So Texas Tech will get the football, but that could have been a costly error right there.
It could have been, and he really lucked up there, and that's why I was talking to him. You got to be smarter than that. You are that far away, there's no way you can dive and block that ball. Be smart, do your position. You see right here on his head, the ball's gone. The ball's already gone. There's no reason for him to even dive.
Locker kind of helped him block towards the punter, just incidental contact. Doege on a play fake, deep ball for the sideline and incomplete. He wanted Bradley Marquez, who is a sophomore that they're really excited about. He's a great return guy. He's filling it for Eric Ward, who was banged up at practice this week. But Marquez, it's selected by the Mets in the players draft, number 4. One of the premier running backs in the state of Texas out of Odessa. He does a lot of things well.
Especially if you can play that baseball and football. There's been a few of those guys, Deion Sanders to name one, and Bo Jackson another, that can do both.
Second and 10, a little delay. Kenny Williams getting some action. He gets the carry up to the 30. It'll set up a third and 5 from there. A little bit bigger, sophomore here from Pflugerville, Texas.
Gain of 5 yards.
I've only carried it a couple times. It's haven't had down to run the ball. This is a pass-happy offense. Doege, pressure coming from the backside, delivers it. Marquez the catch, and a first down up to the 39-yard line.
Craig Mager with the tackle.
Craig Mager has to be a little bit more aggressive in what he's doing. Okay, he's a sophomore going against a senior, but he got up there and bump and run, and then he runs off, and he's creating too much space. As a defensive back, you can't give this quarterback that much space because he will squeeze the ball in there every time.
Fresh set of downs for Doege and the Red Raiders. They go with the 4-receiver look, single back. Bobcat showing blitz. Here they come, trying to mix it up. Doege rolling, now he's going to run with it, and he has a first down across midfield and to the Texas Tech, or the Texas State 46. He doesn't run it very often, but he's a mobile guy.
The play was effective because he's a smart enough quarterback to know when nothing's there, fake it, hold the defense enough so he can get outside. Like you said, he's not the great runner, but he used his mind and the fake motion to get those yards.
14-yard pickup, first down at the Texas State 46. Red Raiders in control from the outset here. Deep ball from Doege, down the middle for Kennard, and it's broken up. Good coverage step for step. Daryl Morris was right with him.
Daryl Morris did what needed to happen earlier when the first pass interference. He stayed on that upfield shoulder of the receiver, and as the ball's coming down, now he makes a play for it. They will never call that as pass interference. Great play by Daryl Morris.
Kennard had a couple touchdown catches in their opener. Big play guy, big target at 6'3". Second and 10. Again, 2 receivers to each side for Doege. Underneath, catch made by Jakeem Grant. Makes a man miss, and there he goes. Grant 5-6 into the open field to the 20. Grant to the 10. Grant to the end zone. And they're going to mark him out. Just shy of the goal line.
That was a huge play. And it's big for one main reason. He's only 5'6". So when he gets his ball underneath, look at the jigging he does. He jukes in and out, then uses his speed, gets outside, makes a great big play.
From Mesquite, Texas, All-State football and track, pint-sized is fair to say. But when he gets the Jets going, look out.
Well, I think of guys I played against like Dave Meggett, Glenn Milbourne, these little scat backs. And so that's exactly where Grant is right now, 5'6", 163 pounds, and just scoots around.
There are many guys I'm bigger than, but he is something special in the open field. Three running backs next to Doege now, and now we have the official blowing the whistle before the snap of the football. Timeout, Texas Tech.
Coach Tumberville was out by the numbers. He clearly did not like something he saw, and he wanted that timeout and got it.
6:02 to go. Everything rolling the Red Raiders way, up 14-0, and looking for more on the road in San Marcos. First and goal from the four. Doege back in the end zone. And did he get the foot down? He did. Touchdown, Darren Moore. His second of the game. 20-0, Red Raiders.
Darren Moore, using his size, gets to the back of the end zone. Seth puts the ball right where only his guy can catch it. Look at this touch. Right there in front. DB had no chance. Craig Mayer's having a tough day right now going against the bigger receiver there.
Yeah, both feet in. He only needed one. The left foot was down first. Buston's extra point is through there. 21-0, Texas Tech. And the fans, many coming over from Lubbock, loving what they're seeing here. And they have really delivered a knockout punch here in the first quarter. It's 5:56 to go, but it's been a dominant effort early going.
Right, well, Texas State fans remember last year when they went up to Lubbock and they went in leading at halftime, 10-9, was driving down the beginning of the third quarter, turnover. And that's from that point, they ended up losing 50-10. And so this team right now, they came out starting well on the first drive, but then turnovers have cost them early, and they haven't been able to recover yet.
Look, everyone knows Texas Tech's going to put big numbers on the board. They've got a national honors candidate in Doege at quarterback. They've got the receivers and the running backs. The question is, can their defense sustain it through the course of the year against Big 12 competition? What we've seen so far in week one and then the first quarter here is they're much improved from a year ago.
And this is the issue that plagued them. And the fact that They dominated the team last week, and they started this game giving up a little bit, but it was the bend don't break, like the old Buffalo Bills, and to get the turnover when you need the big play. And that's exactly what this defense is doing right now. They're making the big plays when they need them, and now they got an opportunity to pin their ears back and go after them because they're down.
Kramer Fife with the kickoff. This will be returnable. Battle at the 7. Fumbles it, picks it up, spins into traffic, and he'll go down at the 20-yard line. This is a Texas State team, again, that beat Houston on the road last week and really stifled that team. It shocked a lot of people, including people throughout the Western Athletic Conference.
Well, the big thing between last week and this week was they didn't turn the ball over. This game, they've turned the ball over, and it's cost them big time.
Here's a look at what they did. They jumped on him quickly, and then they shut him down in the second half, and Rutherford was fantastic, pass and run.
And the running is what got it going. The balance attack, running the triple option, it made a big difference.
And just one first down allowed, or third down conversion allowed, pretty impressive. And there's a pass that could have been intercepted. That was thrown behind Erickson, the intended receiver. Don't know if he was ready for it, and it hung in the air for a bit. Second down and 10.
And you're looking at Terrence Bullitt reacting on this play, just coming back. That's athleticism for you right there. 6'3", 221, the Sam backer, making a play when he wasn't even in the zone.
We're glad to have him back. He had an injury, banged up his shoulder in the opener. No structural damage, had shoulder surgery in the offseason. All Big 12 candidate. Former safety playing that Sam linebacker. Second down. Rutherford. Gonna hand it off to Franks, nothing doing. Runs into a brick wall. And the thing that stands out about the Red Raiders is they've got guys swarming two and three hats on every play.
Well, Art Kaufman told us this defense is about speed. They want guys running sideline to sideline, swarming the ball, and that's what you're seeing right now. You're looking at these guys, they're leaning fast. Here's the big difference between last year and this year, when you look at how many points per game they're giving up, and I should say yardage per game, that's huge, because when your offense can be proficient like they are, you have a stout defense, you can go a long way.
They were concerned coming in here because it was about assignment football, the key against the option being discipline. They have been that and more. They've been dominant as well. And here's a breakout by Terrence Franks. And finally, something positive for the Bobcats rushing attack, as he carries it for first down at the 36-yard line.
Well, there you're looking at a guy, Terrence Franks, 5'10", 194, has a good little burst, does a good job, gets the ball, makes a good right there move. Cody Davis needed to make the tackle in the hole. He couldn't do it, and the running back does the rest.
Leading rusher a year ago, more of their speed guy, backing up Curry at the running back spot. Total yardage in favor of the Red Raiders. Also have that 88-yard interception return on the defensive end. Rutherford keeping it, finds a seam, and he cracks helmets and goes down at the 42-yard line.
Gain of 5 yards.
He is very effective keeping the football, and, you know, it's not an easy offense to prepare for.
No, it's not, because every time you go against a triple option, it's hard to reproduce that in your offense and your what I like to call the Skelly crew. They can't always do it as well as the opposing team, so it makes it difficult to prepare for all the different nuances and wrinkles that it can pose.
Did you ever run any scout team quarterback for the opposing D when you played?
I was never fortunate enough to do
You're
that.
You're probably smart enough never to do it. Rutherford rolling left and incomplete. It'll set up a third and short.
You know, this drive is very important. The reason it's important is, think of it like a Mike Tyson Holyfield fight back in the day. You get knocked around that first round. If you survive it, can you start to come back? They've taken some serious blows in this first quarter. If they can go down here and put any points on the board, I think it settles them down, it gets them in sync, and they can see if the defense can then come back out and maybe get a stop.
Fresh bodies out there. Cody Matthews, big 6'4 target, is on the field. He split bottom of the screen. Here's a handoff on the delay, and that's going to be good enough for the first down. They crossed him up with the inside handoff, and a great effort by Tim Gay as he continues to carry tacklers up to the 48-yard line.
This play was effective because there's a wraparound. When you see him, he's running around. The running back acts like it's a fake. He doesn't really put his hand up. And his third and short, they had no idea that he was going to get the ball, and he just kept going and driving. Good conversion. Keep the play going. The only thing I would like to see them do, offensive coordinator Mike Schultz, I'd like to see him go a little no huddle here. Speed up the tempo, get his guys going, and see if he can get points on the board.
First down from the 48-yard line. And here's a pass downfield on the flea flicker, and it didn't fool anybody. Rutherford hands it off to Franks, back to Rutherford, and they can't pull it off.
The hard part, if you look to the right, he had his tight end, Chase Harper. He does it little okey-doke, I like to call it, the pitch back. And there's no chance. The Texas Tech defense was ready for that play. The chance he would have had was to get to Chase Harper on the bottom side of the screen, but he never saw him. He never looked his way.
Eugene Nebo, the senior corner, was not fooled. And it's second and 10 now. This Texas State team knows where their bread is buttered, though. That's in the run game. They'd like to be able to control clock and keep it away from Doege and company. In motion is Isaiah Battle. Rutherford, handoff straight ahead, Franks, and still running hard. He does not go down easily to the Red Raiders 48.
And this is what you have to do. You got to take a chance in it. Coach Franchione always says they have some trick plays dialed up. When they feel they can use them, they'll go for them, and that's what they did. It didn't give them much success, but this is a situation, like I said, I would love for them to go no huddle, to get the tempo up a little bit, help this offense get a little sharper, and keep the defense off kilter.
Let's look at what Franks did last year, their leading rusher in 8 starts. He averaged almost 6 yards per carry for Texas State. They were an FBS independent, kind of in no man's land last year. This year in the WAC, a lot to play for, excited to be in an FBS conference. 3rd and 7. And now some confusion. And a timeout.
Timeout, Texas State.
The offense was expecting some type of adjustment on the defense when they went to that no back motion, and when it didn't happen, the coaches on the sideline immediately ran out there to call timeout because it was a busted play. And you can see from the receivers they saw it was a busted play.
You know, there's a rich tradition here. Of course, Franchione part of that, but you got to go back to 1904. They were originally Southwest Texas State. Their football history, rich in the Lone Star, the Southland, made the move to the WAC. They're off to the Sun Belt next year, but they have a couple national titles thanks to Jim Wacker. And, you know, they love their football this time of year, the former TCU head coach. And, you know, it's Jim Wacker Field, of course, won titles in 81 and 82. And, you know, Franchione understands that level of football, having been at Pittsburgh State. And then he was at Southwest Texas State in 90 and 91. And they had success during his tenure at that time.
Yeah, you know, these programs, a lot of people don't realize the dominance that they would have had because you don't hear them so much this day and age, but this program's been around a long time and been very successful.
3rd and long now. Rutherford flushed out of the pocket, throws on the run, and just gets rid of the football. Nothing available as he was being chased down by Delvon Simmons, the 290-pound nose tackle who they're really excited about. Sideline to sideline, a nose tackle chasing you down.
Well, and I would like to see Rutherford use his legs a little bit more. I understand he's trying to sit back in that pocket, but when you get back there, with the speed he has, if nothing's there, he really needs to take off and go. And that's what I would like to see a little bit more. And in this situation, I think they're going to go for it. Or the old Randall Cunningham punt.
The pooch punt,
huh? The pooch punt, but we'll see what happens here. The way their defense has been playing, I would think a pooch punch would be better, but we'll see what they do in this play.
It's really set up the Red Raiders in good shape if the Bobcats can't convert. 4th and 7, they're going to punt it out of there. Left-footed punt, and an effective one from Rutherford. Inside the 5, and do they down it? At the 1, they do. Great effort by Andy Erickson getting down there. Oh, no, they're going to call a touchback. He stepped into the end zone. He was in the end zone. It will be a touchback, and They do not pin him deep. Here's another look.
The impact of that play could have been so huge. You have to know where you are. And right there, he's trying to get so close. He had no business doing it. He should have grabbed the ball when it was at the one-yard line. This is what Coach Francione is trying to get this young team to understand. When you have opportunities to make plays, you have to make them. And Andy Erickson didn't take advantage of that opportunity.
The Red Raiders will get it back, and the only silver lining for Francione is this time they have to start. Now they're going to mark it at the one. Nets marked at the one now. Here's a look at the last drive. Deege.
You see him scrambling, getting out of the pocket, using his legs. The nice pass there to Grant. Grant getting it done. An outside with the little guy, and then right there, the big touchdown at the end to Darren Moore.
Now they're going to mark the football at the one as Stevens carries it up to the three-yard line. They say he got it downed at the one.
And I think the rule, in the NFL, the rule is you cannot go in the end zone and touch the ball. But I believe in college, they're allowing the person, once he touches the ball, if he touches inbound in the field of play, that's where it stops, once he touches.
He still would have been better, sir, just to bat the ball back towards the five-yard line.
Yes.
Just to make it safe. But regardless, the Red Raiders are backed up, second and eight. Single back is Stevens. Haven't seen a lot of the run game from the Red Raiders. Here he is, left tackle, and gives him some breathing room up to the 26-yard line. Stevens is a guy that's come off a serious knee injury, dislocated left knee, ended his season against Texas A&M. He had five starts and over 500 yards and eight touchdowns prior to that injury. He had a Big 12 all-conference season awaiting him, and then the tough injury.
Yeah, and it was tough. They felt that their offense slipped when he went out. They feel he's a slasher, and they think he's about 80-85%. He's not to his point yet, but they think he'll be there within a couple of weeks.
Third and five. Here he is again. Straight ahead. Has the seam. Look out. Eric Stevens. One man to beat, and he's chased down from behind by Craig Mager at the 49-yard line. Stevens almost took it the distance.
You're talking about a hat-on-hat seam right there, and then the slasher does the rest. Eric Stevens cutting up the seam, and you can see right there, doesn't have the complete burst like he had last year yet, and being caught from behind, I'm sure his fellow running backs are going to give him some guff in the meeting room come next week.
46 yards for the senior from Mansfield, Texas, and that is the final play of this first quarter. A dominant quarter for the visitors from Lubbock, Texas. Couple touchdown catches from Darren Moore, and the big defensive play from Davis as well. 21-0, Red Raiders, second quarter coming up. Texas Tech rolling as we open up the second quarter. Red Raiders have the football already. A couple touchdown passes from Doege to Darren Moore, and a Cody Davis interception return, and they're on the march again at the Bobcats 49 as we start the second. Doege to the air, underneath, and Jakeem Grant the catch and a 2 yard pickup, and that's it. Short yardage. Phillip Benning the safety on the play.
Gain of 2 yards, second and 8.
Guy reminds me a little bit of Darren Sproles too, just quick and speedy, tries to get underneath you.
Play fake, rolling right, and again underneath, and a catch.
Pass complete to Tyson Williams.
To Williams, who's come into the game, as the Red Raiders rotate a lot of different people. And Tyson Williams, who plays tight end and also is a receiver, redshirt freshman, with the catch and the first down to the 39-yard line. Fifth-year senior, I should say. Doege down the middle, and he wants Kennard and can't come up with it at the 10-yard line. Here comes the flag. It comes in late on Darryl Morris, and it was a mismatch. Morris at 5'10 against Kennard at 6'3.
I really don't agree with that play. The DB did a good job. Watches the balls in the air. Now he comes across, and what they're trying to say is, look at the back arm. He doesn't pull on him. As long as there's no pulling, they usually don't call that as pass interference. He didn't alter his body movement in any way as he went for the ball. I really don't think that was a good call. And I'm not being biased just because I'm DB. Yeah,
well, these corners have had their hands full. But from the outset, you know, I hear you, though. They have really had a tough time keeping up with the Red Raiders' speed here. First down out the 24. Doege over the middle and wide open. And the catch is made for the touchdown. Hauled in by Alex Torres, the senior from El Paso. Just his second catch of the year. His first for a score, and it's 27-0.
Talk about a psych play. Doege hides the ball, pulls it up, zips it in there, and you're seeing Torres wide open because of the run fake.
Three-year starter, over 1,900 career yards receiving, leads all Tech receivers, and they add to their lead here. Third touchdown pass for Doege as he is mounting some big numbers here in the first half. Buston tacks on one more, 28-0.
One after his Goodyear score, Texas
right
Tech
here, Coach Franchione has to somehow get his team under control, maybe even make a quarterback switch at this point in time, just so that your offense can get productive. They've moved it a little bit, but when you really needed the pass, it hasn't happened. So he has to find a way, because this defense cannot stay out there forever, as you're seeing. Points from follow up.
Six plays, 99 yards, and Torres caps it off with the touchdown grab. 28-0 for the Raiders. 28-0 Texas Tech. The view from up top of the newly renovated Bobcat Stadium here in San Marcos, Texas. Beautiful setting for football and a full house. Texas State was geared up for this one, their fans, but Texas Tech has taken the fun out of the party with 28 first half points, the latest to catch by Torres for a score as Kramer Fife kicks it away. Battle 2 yards deep out of the end zone. And Isaiah Battle run down at the 19.
Isaiah Battle on the return. And out to the 20-yard line.
Black helmets down there to make the play. Summit Hogue, redshirt freshman from Lubbock, on the play. Texas State now needs to start building, doing the little things. And their bread and butter is running the football. They've not been able to throw it well at all, as Rutherford's 0 for 7 through the air and a pick.
Right.
And they make a change here.
And I think it's a smart change. You have to go with what's going to help your offense move. You can't let this game get so far out of hand that your guy's demeanor gets beat down. You need somebody to come out there and make some plays. And so we'll see what Tyler can come out here and do.
Tyler Arndt, 8 career starts. They wanted to rotate these two guys last week over the middle and incomplete. As he's looking for the big tight end, Chase Harper, the guy we talked about in the open. Off the mark with that one.
Kind of hard for him to step complete. That ball sailed high, and it sailed high because defensive tackle Donnell Wesley was right into his chest as he released that ball. So as a quarterback, if I can't follow through and step through, that ball is going to sail.
So second and 10 now for Arndt, a guy that last year threw for 576 yards and 3 touchdowns. Highly rated at Aquero, Texas. Played the Texas All-Star game. And going deep downfield and overshoots everybody. Battle within 10 yards of it, but a couple Red Raiders were here to that football.
Well, that's, you see him shaking his head. That's another miscommunication. He expected the receiver to be doing a corner route, and the receiver kept going on a post route, so the ball was thrown completely to the outside, and that's why nobody was there. You can see the receiver coming up on the inside right here, and he stops, and then instead of continuing outside, and that's why the ball sailed so far out.
He's actually started games each of the last 2 years part-time. And Coach Francione's team facing a 3rd and 10. They'll swing it out of the backfield to Terrence Franks, trying to reverse his field. Franks gets a block, and Franks picks up a first down after the 34-yard line. Great individual effort there to keep the drive going. Cody Davis on the tackle.
Franks took a busted play and made something out of nothing. You're going to see the ball's floating a little too high. Nothing's there. He cuts back all the way across field, uses his speed, puts the ball in the right hand so that it doesn't get stripped. And there's Cody Davis saving a touchdown. Because if he doesn't make that tackle, there's nobody else between Franks and that end zone.
Something positive for this Bobcats offense with Arndt now at the helm. Handoff straight ahead. Nope, they're going to keep it. He's going to keep it. Arndt on the edge. Nice play fake. He fooled a lot of people on that one. Up to the 49-yard line. Pick up a 16.
Now, Arndt doesn't have Rutherford speed, but he has size. 6'4", 221. So he's able to break arm tackles. And you're going to see right here as he does the option. Here comes the arm tackle. If you do not wrap up on him, and Bullitt didn't, he's going to break that arm tackle and get those positive yards.
He looks very comfortable running that option. And Arndt, big 6'4 frame, showing he has some wheels as well. Their 6th first down. Texas Tech dominating here in the second quarter. Bobcats looking to get on the board. It's time they send Franks in motion and a timeout. Timeout is called on the field by the Red Raiders. And Tommy Tuberville will talk things over on the defensive side. Well, two new head coaches look to keep the momentum rolling as Tim Beckman and the Fighting Illini head west to take on Todd Graham's Arizona State Sun Devils for a Big Ten Pac-12 matchup. Illinois, Arizona State tonight at 10:30 on ESPN and also live on Watch ESPN. Intriguing matchup in the desert, Arizona State, with Todd Graham now at the helm as their new head coach, and he's got a good one in Taylor Kelly, That was last week against NAU. Can he duplicate that against a Big Ten team?
Well, that's the question. That's where I live, and so the talk has been, it's nice that you did it against NAU, but can you do it against a Big Ten opponent and the rest of the Pac-12? And so a lot's going to be told tonight, and we'll see how this offense, because they've never run the spread before. So this is they got one game under their belt. We'll see how the second one comes around.
Texas State fans disappointed in what they've seen here in the first half. 28-0. Three touchdown passes already for Seth Doege, who's up for a number of national honors. And now Texas State with Tyler Arndt, a junior, trying to get something going for the Bobcats. From the 48, underneath, and hanging on with the catch is Benjamin Aija, and that's a good enough grab for 5 yards to the 46.
This throw
was a back shoulder throw, and that's a zip on the ball to make sure that only his receiver can get that ball. He had the defender draped on him, Eugene, but he still was able to make that catch. Big play by the freshman.
Aija's 6'3", redshirt sophomore from San Diego. Second and four now. Arndt rolling and throwing and completing, and it's a first down grab. And Tim Hawkins on the move, and he has a first down. Flag comes in late as he's knocked out of bounds at the 28-yard line. So pushing and shoving going on after that play.
Rolling out, getting people. This play was effective because he got the quarterback out a little bit, got some receiver in open space, and Franks, Tim Hawkins does the rest, and that looks like it's a late hit out of bounds. You watch right here. No, that looks like it was inbound, so I don't understand why the flag.
They're going deep into their bench here as they'll sort the flag out. They're going to back up the Bobcats.
Right. And that's why Waterville's jumping up and down.
There was some extracurricular after the play, but holding 10 yards back to the 40, they will have a first down from there.
Oh, right there. You can see the center, Matt Freeman. Once the guy's by you, you got to let him go.
From the 40 now, Aija will go in motion. Play fake. Arndt's in some trouble. Dumps it off. And that's going to be for lost yardage as a flag comes in late. After the play, that was the tight end, Chase Harper. He loses 3 yards. We'll have to sort out a flag in the backfield as well. And this is going against the Red Raiders, so they get bailed out on that play.
Dropping the passer on Texas Tech. First down.
Gotta be smart about it. You gotta be smart about it. You gotta watch what the quarterback's doing, and once he's by, you can't make plays like that. Your defense just did a good thing. Gotta stop or got a holding, still got the first down, but you gotta be smarter than that. You're going to see this. The quarterback gets the ball out, throws it, now you'd be done, and then he gives them a shove. They're going to call that every time. Doesn't matter. Pro, college, high school, they're about protecting the quarterback, and if you do those types of things, they will throw a penalty.
Leon Mackey, the senior defensive tackle, hitting Arndt after the pass had been delivered, so a first down, 15-yard penalty to the Red Raiders 25. Three receivers, Arndt starting to open up this offense a little bit. Looking for the end zone. He's got a man. It's caught by Franks. Touchdown, Bobcats. They're on the board.
Touchdown, Bobcats.
This is what you're talking about. You bring in Arndt, get a spark. Franks doesn't rest. Gets up the sideline on a little out and up route. You can see the linebacker is so upset with himself. Sam O'Galvin, because he's like, the guy got behind me. The defense is playing so well, but good points on the board for Texas State.
Will Johnson for the extra point. And the home fans have something to cheer about the 10:54 mark. Terrence Franks has been the workhorse for Texas State. A touchdown grab to get his team on the board, now trailing by 21. Great crowd here at newly renovated Bobcat Stadium in San Marcos. 28-7 Texas Tech. State gets on the board for the first time. Arnt to Franks.
And you can see right there, it's this little pump fake to pull the linebacker up. And this is what is dynamic about the play. You took advantage of the defense, and you got yourself an end zone. And you can see Franks right there. And this is what this offense needed. They needed the spark. Now, maybe the defense can go out there. Now the crowd's back into it. See if you can make a play, get the crowd into it, and maybe get a stop. Three and out.
Jason Dan to kick it away. It's muffed. And picking the ball up with a flag down is Texas Tech's Sedale Foster, and he's finally dragged down at the 35-yard line. No flag on the field. There is a white cloth at the 26. A lot of pushing and shoving. It has been physical out there. Let's take a look at the Red Raiders. They had the defensive touchdown, and they have struck quickly, with the exception of that 99-yard drive.
Right, right. And you can see this play selection. They got a little run in there, but they're spreading the ball around and spreading this defense out, taking advantage of things, but getting points on possession of the ball.
Doege has been sharp, efficient in every way. He's looking for the deep ball here. Far sideline, incomplete. Wanted Darren Moore, and there's a flag. These corners are really being tested. Moore with that size. Craig Mager, the guilty party, it appears there.
You have to turn around as a defensive back. When you watch this, Mager does not turn towards the quarterback, and by the time he does, it's too late. When that receiver stops, they're going to call that every time because you impeded the progress to the ball.
So a 15-yard walk-off as Texas State's corners are really having a tough time. There's the numbers. Five penalties thus far against the Bobcats. And Moore's tough for anybody to deal with. It's 6'4 and 216.
Well, and you got to be smart when you play against a big receiver.
From midfield, pressure coming. Bobcats bringing the blitz. Doege downfield. It's Bell. He can't come up with it. Had it in his sights at the 10-yard line.
Sure did. Nice play there by Darryl Morris. Once the ball got into Javon Bell's hands, he broke it up. He came through and stripped it. And you're going to see, this is a big play. The ball's there. He has the catch. It goes through his hands, and he makes sure he can't hold on to it. Bell should have had it, but look at the pressure starting to come in there. That's what this defense has to do. They have to find a way to get Doege on his backside, even if it's not with the ball in his hands, to start to make him think.
They got to give those corners some relief. Second down and 10 at the 50 now. Setting up the screen, catch is made over the middle. Ball is fumbled. It's recovered by the Bobcats. Jordan Davis the catch. And recovered by Steven Smith of the Bobcats.
This play is a very impactful play right now. It's a jailhouse break. The ground caused that fumble. We're going to see if it gets overturned there. We're going to see as the receiver catches the ball and he starts to go down. He hits the ground and the ball comes out. And no matter what level you are, the ground cannot cause a fumble.
I think you're right on it, partner.
Still a nice energy play for this defense, for the crowd. They're going to be a little upset when they find out it's overturned, but they have to take that energy. That was a jailhouse break screen right there. They're fortunate that he tripped his own guy. Otherwise, he might have took it to the house. There was nobody there. They had a blitz on, but you can see right there the ball clearly hit the ground, and the ground cannot cause a fumble.
They are looking at this, and Dennis Francione hoping it goes his way. You know, Deggy's already put up some amazing numbers, but he's so good with the touch ball, the screen over the middle, not just the deep ball, and that's talked about a lot. He's got all the tools, a quarterback.
And it's the velocity. A lot of people say, well, what does that mean? It means when you throw it to a sideline throw, you got to put a lot of heat on that ball, velocity to get it out there. But the same thing means when you throw it a short throw, you have to have the right velocity to take enough off of it so that, A, your receiver can catch it, but, B, it's not this floater where the defender can get to it. So he has a great grasp of how to get that ball out of his hand. And, again, that's why he's up for all these dope awards and all these other kind of awards, is because he knows what to do.
Well, they're going to continue to look at this, it appeared to us that the ground caused the fumble. Here's another look.
You can see right there as he trips over his own lineman and he goes down, the ball is still with him. Now he hits the ground and it comes out. The only thing I can say, if they want to say that the ball was starting to come loose before he went down, but it doesn't really look like that in my opinion. And I think Texas Tech is going to retain this ball. In the likelihood that they do, now you're going to have a second and four. I think at this point, Texas State has to start to dial up some more blitzes. Craig Nevier, the defense coordinator, he has to find a way to put more pressure to help his corners out, because what we're seeing right now is this speedy receiver core, which he talked about, they were nervous about, the speedy, good-sized receiving core. It's definitely giving his corners fits. And if he doesn't get pressure on them, they're going to continue to push them downfield for these big plays.
Remember, the ruling on the field is a fumble recovered by Texas State. Is there enough to overturn that and give the ball back to Texas Tech? I just heard Jay's thought on that.
I can see that. I like to call them priests sometimes. They're like, you know, they're doing, because it's like, I'm sorry, this is what we see. This is what we see.
We're going to get the call here. Here's another look. The catch by Davis. Has possession. Hit. Ball comes out. That is clearly a catch, and then the ball comes free. What's the ruling here? Call has been reversed, which means Texas Tech is going to keep the football. Now, that is a catch, and then the ground causes the fumble, so the ball is dead at the 43. Possession to the Red Raiders.
Yeah, I think that's the correct call. That's what I saw when I saw it. His own guy is the one that did it to him, so now are they looking for to make sure the ball is placed at the correct spot? Meaning when he went down and the ball came out, to make sure that they're marking the ball where he came out at.
It is second down. That was a 7-yard pickup by Davis, and they haven't squared away. It's third down now. Third down and three. After the catch by Davis, Red Raiders have it at the Bobcats 43-yard line, looking to add to their lead as we near the 10-minute mark here in the second quarter. Four receivers, Kennard a big target at the bottom of the screen at 6'3". Showing blitz, they're coming. Doege underneath, and it's caught off the deflection by Amaro, and a first down to the 19-yard line. And that was an opportunity for a pick for Jason McClain. Their safety couldn't hang on.
Well, you're going to see a lost opportunity. Here's an interception opportunity right there by Justin Uwiji. And if he just holds on to that ball, he could go the other way. But because he doesn't, Jason Morrow, great concentration, grabs that ball, gets the conversion.
It was Uwiji, their safety, that had the opportunity. Amaro, a guy that Tommy Tuberville singled out to us this week as a star in the making. He's got the size at 6'5", 257. You can also split him out.
And he said this is the first tight end that's been on this roster in a very long time, because Coach Leach, when he was there, didn't get tight end. So he's trying to incorporate the tight end more into this offense. He said two things, tight end offense, and then he's also said defensively they wanted to get faster and be more aggressive. And I think so far this season, those two things have happened.
And we have another official review. What could they be looking at here, Jay? A deflection and the catch by Amaro.
Yeah, I don't understand, because clearly he should have had an interception. He didn't. So it's nothing more than a tip ball. So I'm not sure what they're reviewing.
They have it squared away. It will stand as what we saw. First down, Red Raiders at the Texas State 19. In the red zone now. Kenny Williams in as the setback. Pressure coming again. Doege lobs it up for the end zone. Amaro, he's got it. Touchdown, Red Raiders. And there's Amaro's ability right there with the size and that athletic ability.
Right now, this play was so effective because you have a tight end that's 6'5", going against a defensive back. He gets the position upfield on him. Craig Meyer had no chance to make a play on that, especially when you go and gets a guy 6'5", 260 pounds.
His first career start last week at four catches. First career touchdown grab right there. Buston stays perfect on PATs, and it's 35-7. Red Raiders. Jay Sabaro, the sophomore from San Antonio, Texas, beats his man to the football. Texas Tech rolls.
Red Raiders. Seth Doege has not disappointed. 192 yards, four touchdowns, strikes as he hooks up with his tight end, Jace Amaro, for a score. And midway through the second quarter, Texas Tech flexing their muscles here. This is a team that was picked ninth out of 10 teams in the Big 12. Hard to believe this is the ninth place team. It is a very good conference. They're going to, I think, surprised a lot of people this year. Kickoff by Fife. Battle at the 3-yard line for Texas State across the 20. And Isaiah Battle runs into a pile at the 25-yard line.
Isaiah Battle on the return.
And a hurt Bobcat as well.
Summit Hogue with the tackle.
In the area. And that is a, is that Craig Mager? The corner, he's had a tough night, and that would add to his concerns, and hopefully that's not serious.
It always makes it tough on a special teams play when certain things like that happen.
No,
it's the guy gets hurt and squirming around. And
it's Colby Targan, a sophomore from Chaparral High School in Scottsdale, Arizona, the same high school that produced Paul Konerko. Hargan's going to come off.
It looks like it could be a forearm, a shoulder. Usually when you see a guy squirming on the ground like that and not moving that body part, you know it's usually something of that nature.
So from the 26-yard line, Arndt's going to hand it off. And a big gainer off the right side. As they go to a different running back this time, Isaiah Battle, who carries it from his H-back position from left to right.
Play work because this defense has been so stout, expecting to pass and come out with the first play on the run. Battle does a good job of just getting the ball, getting to the edge, and breaking downfield.
they've responded to Arndt as the starter. They're playing with more passion right now on that side of the ball.
Well, he's definitely a better passer. And you can see by the way he's throwing the ball, he can definitely get it to all spots.
First down at the 40 now. Fakes the handoff this time. Will keep it running right. Arndt trying to get to the edge and does not get much. Run out of bounds at the 43-yard line. Pick up a three.
This defense is very fast. And Coach Franchione talked about that. He goes, they're very quick to the ball. If you're going to go sideways, you have to make sure you find that seam to hit that foot and go. If you don't, if you continue sideways, they're going to close on you.
Second down and seven now. Arndt coming out of high school. I mentioned he was at the Texas All-Star game. ESPN ranked him one of the top 32 quarterbacks in the nation coming out of high school. A lot of upside for the junior. He's getting an opportunity to showcase his skills here in place of Sean Rutherford. Handoff straight ahead.
Tim Gay,
and
the ball
short carry. Gain to the 46-yard line. Set up a third down as Tim Gay gets the carry, the redshirt freshman.
This right now is what I call, okay, guys, back to the basics, X and O's. Let's just put a play together at a time. Let's see if we can put a series together. Let's get a first down and just see what we can do to move the ball down the field. Because at this point, you don't want your guys to say, let's just check out. No, let's stick with the basics.
Third and five now. Clock rolling toward the 7-minute mark. It's been all Red Raiders. And now a timeout called by Texas State.
Timeout, Texas State.
You talked about how, you know, that's what they want to do. They want to run the football. They dominated time of possession at Houston, 43 minutes to 17 minutes in that win. They controlled the line of scrimmage. Different story tonight.
Different story. You're going against a team that's much bigger, also much faster, and so, and deeper. As we've watched, they've rotated in a lot of people. So I think in this type of situation, what they were able to achieve last week, they're having a tougher time, and the guys are not responding to the adversity they had at the beginning of this game.
After the timeout, third and five. Important to pick up this first down, keep the football, not let the Red Raiders have it. They have plenty of time to go and score once more before the break here.
I think you hit the nail on the head there, Trey. I think you want to put another score on him before you go to half.
Three receiver look for Arndt. Battle in motion. Arndt, quick strike over the middle, catch for a first down. Hauled in by Cody Matthews, the junior from San Antonio, his second catch of the year. First down to the Red Raiders 40.
That is a very good pass. Zips it in there. You're seeing what happens when you're 6'4 and you got a good size arm like he does. Like you said, the rated coming out of high school in one of the top 50s. And this is the type of throws that this offense needs to get themselves on track.
Pretty solid as he has moved them up and down the field looking for the second score here. Matthews, a big 6'4 target. He split to the left side. Arndt, deep drop, deflected at the line of scrimmage. He was looking for Gay, his running back out of the backfield. And that was, I think, Pete Robertson, the right end that got a hand on him. There he is, the redshirt freshman from Longview, Texas.
Well, one of the things he definitely has to work at is he needs to look off his receivers. Right now, because of getting into the game, he's staring where he's going. Watch his eyes. He's looking left, looking left, looking left. He doesn't even look right. So it makes it easy for the defense to know where he wants to go with the ball. He has to be better at moving his eyes to move the defense so that he can find the receiver he wants to get the ball to.
That was actually Delvon Simmons, his 6'5 frame. He got his hand up there. Robertson 6'3. They have a lot of size on that front wall. Second down and 10. Running the option. They'll go straight ahead and nothing doing.
Tim Gay on the carry.
Shut down at the line of scrimmage. Texas Tech with Will Smith, the middle linebacker, and Simmons as well, double teaming them. That is two very, very good athletes. Two guys that could get all conference honors with what they do on the field.
Well, and I like the size and the speed of them. You're looking at a middle linebacker, 6'3", 224 pounds, but yet he has the strength and the speed to beat those front linemen to where he needs to get. And that's what's huge. So think of Ray Lewis. being able to make the tackles. He knows where the hole is, and he gets there before the blocker does.
Some movement up front. Third down, and the completion to Cody Matthews will be short of the stick. Dropped at the 36-yard line. As Smith is there on the tackle, and now fourth down territory. You got to think the Bobcats go for it here.
Oh, you got to go for it every time, in my opinion, in this kind of situation. Unless you pin back inside your 20, you're on the other side of the field. Use these big receivers. I'm liking what they're doing because they saw what Texas Tech did to them, using the big receivers walling off the DBs. So do the exact same thing. Cody Matthews catching that ball, wall somebody off. He's 6'4", going against Eugene Nebo. He was only 5'10".
Vince Franchione says he always has a few trick plays up his sleeve. Is this the time for it on fourth down? Rolling right, Arndt throws, he delivers. First down grab by Battle, and he's run out of bounds at the 27-yard line. Tackle made by Trey Porter, the nickelback.
Now right here, I'd like to see him go no huddle, but the play was effective because he just rolled out, and you see him right there. Battle just finds the open space, gets to there, allows the ball to get to him, and gets out of bounds. Good catch, puts it away. Gets the first down. That's what this offense needs. And I would love to see them go no huddle. I think they could be a little bit more effective if they were doing that.
We hit the five-minute mark here in San Marcos. 35-7 Red Raiders. It's been the Seth Doege Show with four touchdown passes. But Arndt looking to lead his team to another score. Pump fake going deep. Down for Brandon Smith. And he overshoots him in the corner. Good coverage applied by Eugene Nebo.
Right, and that was a bad throw. He wanted to pump and go, but he didn't look. He had two receivers running to pump and go. He didn't differentiate which one he was trying to go to. He just threw it up there. You got to pick a guy and see it's there. The defense did a great job of reading and snuffing it out. So a smart play would have been, if nothing was there, go through your check down or scramble and see if you get a few positive yards.
Smith, the guy he was looking for, has 4-5 speed. He's going to be split left this time. Also out there, Tim Hawkins, the senior receiver. Hawkins will go in motion. Hawkins loops behind the backfield. Arndt's going to run the option, pitches it to Hawkins, and Hawkins inside the 20-yard line. There's a wrinkle. Put the receiver in motion. Interesting setup on that play.
Well, Art Kaufman talked about defensive coordinator for Texas Tech. We have to be sound discipline-wise. You see right here, they weren't sound discipline because as they got out, nobody was on the pitch, man. You only had one guy trying to cover the quarterback and the pitch. Right there, DJ Johnson, number 12, was trying to cover both, and he couldn't do it, and that's why they were able to get positive yards.
Hawkins is going to check out after that run. It sets up a third and 5 at the 22. Battle and Erickson back in as receivers. And Texas State has done what they do well, rush the football. They know where they hang their hat, trying to keep this drive going. Handoff. Battle, nothing doing. Now it's fourth down.
Now they just went from doing a good play to a bad play. You have a team on their heels. No huddle allows you to reset the tempo of the game. It also helps you catch a defense in a defense that they may not want to be in. And so that's why I think it's huge that they should do that. But they're going to try it for the field goal right now.
Dennis Franchione trying to get three out of this. It would be another scoring drive with Arndt at the helm. Johnson from 38 yards. He's 3 of 4 on the year. Kick on the way. Plenty of leg and through there. So Will Johnson, the sophomore for Bryan, Texas, makes it 35-10. There's questions about whether he would play today, dealing with a nagging groin injury. Looks pretty good on the placements.
Well, and I think what they're doing right now is they're just saving him 4 field goal attempts, which I think is smart. This kid's leg and groin, I think, is injured a bit because he does everything. When you have one guy that does your kickoffs, field goals, and punts, he's definitely going to get tired. Last week, he had 3 or 4 field goals. He did the kickoffs, and he had 6 punts. So that will wear you out.
35-10 here. Let's take a look at some college football headlines and some sad news out of Tulane. Devon Walker suffering a broken neck and collapsed lung against Tulsa. Our thoughts and prayers go out to that kid, and you know how tough it can be to play defensive back. The collisions that go on out there.
And you always are told, watch out around the piles, and he was around the pile when that happened, and our prayers go out to him to get better and his family as well.
Urban Meyer and company with Braxton Miller rolling to a win over UCF as well. As Ohio State, a bit closer than they anticipated, but a comfortable win nonetheless.
Well, the Urban Meyer era has begun, and got a couple wins there. I think that everybody's excited to see how this team fares once they get in the Big Ten play.
Jason Dan to kick it away. And a return for Texas Tech. It's Sedale Foster, and a good return across the 40 and up to the 47-yard line. Sedale Foster, who doubles as a running back.
Sedale
He's
Foster
the third
the
guy behind Stevens and Williams from Riverside Junior College in California.
The special team return game for Texas Tech has been great. You're seeing he's just getting behind blockers. They're getting a hat on a hat and just allowing the returner to do the rest. Coach Franciano has to be very upset with his special team play because they are not doing good at all during this game.
Look at Deggie's numbers thus far. We are talking almost 200 yards and still plenty of clock to work with here in the second quarter. They completed passes to 13 receivers last week. Already 7 today for Deggie as he goes incomplete over the middle, intended for Darren Moore.
Let's
talk about Seth Deggie today and what he has done, spreading the wealth around. You see him, his ability with the underneath pass, that's been effective.
Well, he understands the game. That's what's important about it. And he takes what the defense gives him. He doesn't force it though.
Hand off, Kenny Williams running hard off the left side, and he spins down to the 46-yard line. He starts Stevens, and then Williams comes in, and he is a power back.
Tackle by number 15,
Jason
McLean.
And he runs a 4.48 as well.
Well, you look at him, I call those guys spark plugs. He's 5'9", 220 pounds. So you're talking about a short guy, big legs, that is already kind of low to the ground. So if you don't come in and wrap him up like they just did in that situation, he's going to break through the first string of tackle.
74 yards in their opening win. Third and 5 now. Texas State fans have been great here, cheering their team on. It's been an uphill battle here in the first half. Deggie underneath to the sideline. A catch made by Marquez, and he's very close to the first down. We'll see where they mark his forward progress. David Mayo, the Mike linebacker, was there. Let's see where they mark it.
You know, we talked to about the break. These corners are coming up trying to bump these DBs, the DBs, and see right there. Craig Mayer
first down, Texas,
tried to bump and run the receiver who is 6'3", 203. So when you go against a guy that's big like that, and you try to get physical with him, he throws you away. That's how these things happen. That's how they got beat on those deep routes. You have to switch up. I personally, when I went against big receivers, I played off. I gave up the slant, and I had a better chance of jumping for the deep route.
The only danger there is with Deggie. He can nickel and dime you all the way down the field. He has a fresh set of downs to work with here. Over the middle, delivers a strike. Close to the first down at the 31-yard line, Jason Amaro, the tight end, and he will not go down. They're going to mark his forward progress good enough for the first down to the 30-yard line.
That's another play. Justin Wuji had a chance cutting underneath. You're going to see this pass. Look at Wuji right there again. Another ball that went through his hands, an opportunity for an interception to help this defense out. That's what's going to happen for this team. They have to make some plays on defense to get themselves off the field.
Nearing the 1 minute mark now, first half. Deggie looking to add to this 35-10 advantage. Williams behind him now. Showing blitz the Bobcats. They'll hand it off to Williams. Has a crease right side inside the 25. And he's a couple yards shy of the first down as that flag comes in after the play.
Kenny Williams, the ball carrier. Penalty flag on the play.
Chippiness by both teams going after guys, hitting them when they're on the ground. Blocking after the play.
This is personal foul against Texas Tech, so that wipes out a good run from Williams.
Guys have to be smarter. Both of these coaches talked about that. Penalties is something that cannot be tolerated. It costs you games, and we've seen in this type of situation, both teams have had good plays brought back because of penalties.
So Tommy Tuberville with the chagrin. There, he's had that look a couple times despite his team dominating this first half. A lot of it has been those silly fouls. Second and 17 Doege to the far side. Williams the catch at the 25. And he's driven out of bounds over
pass
there by Megger.
It was Moore.
And Megger, his hand is full. It's usually been with Moore on that far sideline.
Yeah, I'm seeing a guy that's just nervous in coverage right now. This is a lumber throw. Look at this, what happens. He's so far off. He's so scared of the guy going past him that he's getting way too much cushion. And so you see right now he's up there bump and run again. He needs to back off, play a little deeper.
Bobcats again showing blitz on third and five. Here they come. Doege has time. Catch made short of the first down as it's hauled in by Derek Edwards, and now fourth down coming up.
Pass complete to Derek
Edwards. That was a cover two where the corners were up to jam the receivers.
It's fourth down.
Good call for that play, but you see right now Texas Tech act like they're going to go for it.
So up 35-10. Tuberville has a choice here as Franchione looks on. You take the three here. By the big margin.
Oh, yeah, you definitely take the three here. You know coming out, your defense is going to start. I definitely take the time, run it down, kick the field goal, go into the half. But, you know, you played a solid first half.
And they will take that timeout with 4 seconds to go to set up their place kicker.
Timeout, Texas
Ryan
Tech.
Buston, it appears. Coming up at halftime, you'll want to stay with us from San Marcos, Texas. We'll hear from Texas State Athletic Director Dr. Tice about this newly renovated stadium, about the move to FBS and the excitement around this Texas State program. ESPNU four downs as well, and first half highlights and stats, a lot from the Red Raiders' perspective. Great setting here though, isn't it?
Nice, lovely town. Beautiful campus here, nice, beautiful new stadium. Look at what they've done. I was listening to the local news. I think they said over the past 20 years, they've invested close to $50 million to get the stadium to where it is right now. And I think it's beautiful. It's always nice to come into a nice stadium like this.
And the fans obviously revved up coming into this one after the win at Houston. Here's Ryan Buston now trying to add to the Red Raiders lead to end the half out of the hold of the punter, Ryan Ertzlaven, from 38 yards. And Buston's kick is good. So Buston, a perfect 4-for-4 on the season, and that sums up a pretty big first half from Texas Tech. Dominating in all facets, 38-10. Red Raiders at the break. There have been few highlights for Texas State. Tommy Tuberville's team getting a big effort from Doege and the big lead. 38-10 in San Marcos. Texas Tech trying to move to 2-0. A comfortable lead at the break at Texas State. The Bobcats coming in. Winners on the road at Houston last week. Different story thus far against the visitors from the Big 12. Let's take a look at the first half highlights. It was a Seth Doege show.
Well, Doege getting it done with his accuracy. You're going to see right here, gets the ball in a deep route to Darren Moore. Gets the touchdown there over Craig Mayer. Then you're going to see right here, gets it to Moore again on the backside. He gets the same DB, Craig Mayer. And then you're going to see Alex Torres here get this ball on the little okey-doke, get in the end zone. And then right here, the low tight end on the roster, Jason Morrow, going deep and against the same defensive back there, poor Craig Mayer, just getting beat up over there.
Seth Doege, the fifth-year senior, has had 8 300-yard passing games in his career. He's right on pace for another one. 224, 4 touchdowns. And again, spreading the wealth. See the completions to 7 different guys. That's what he does so well.
And I think that's the maturation of being as smart as he is, understanding what the offense calls for. And defenses can't key on one guy because you don't know who's going to get the ball. You try to take something away, he goes through his progressions and finds the open receiver.
And he may not play 4 quarters tonight. Michael Brewer played last week in a rout, a big victory in week number 1. Let's take a look at the college football scoreboard. Some games of interest. USC knocking off the Orange. Bama rolls K-State. Texas is having a battle with New Mexico.
They surely are. They surely are. And that's kind of shocking. You would think Texas would be a little bit more dominant, but they're definitely struggling there. And then look at TCU just getting all over Grambling State there.
And Oklahoma State, they put 84 on the board against Savannah State. Will they do that at Arizona? Not likely. But I think Cowboys have a good chance to win that game in Tucson.
What I'm curious to see about this game is how many points will be on the board, because if both these offenses are, which are similar in the spread, if the defenses don't show up, it could be an 84-84 kind of game. Arena score, you know?
And how about Georgia-Missouri, the Bulldogs venturing to Columbia?
Now, this is huge, because if Missouri, with all the talk, we already saw Texas A&M come in, and they had a good chance of winning that game. They didn't do it. Missouri feels that they can get out of there with the win.
First SEC game for the Tigers as the Red Raiders will kick it away. And there's Kramer Fife, who's their kickoff specialist from Lake Travis High School in Austin. The backup quarterback, who we may see later, Michael Brewer, also from Lake Travis. A college or a high school football power in Texas. So Texas State will get the football, and they'd like to get back to that ball control thing, possess the ball, get back to the bread and butter. I thought they were more like themselves in the second quarter, at least offensively.
Well, Coach Franciano has to say, you know what, new half, 0-0. Let's go out here and see if we can win this half.
Fife with the kickoff. And out of the end zone, it's Battle across the 25. Hit hard, keeps his feet churning. Great effort by Isaiah Battle to the 30-yard line, and then a flag comes in from the side judge up near the 40-yard line.
Good hard run. You got to be careful. I love the attitude and tenacity.
Austin Stewart the tackle, but also a face mask at the end of the play.
He comes out, he's running hard, trying to create something right there. I'd like him to be a little bit more careful, but he puts the ball away, right position. You can see the face mask right there. And I like the attitude. This is how you want to come out and start. You want to get something done, get your team in a good field position.
And they will have that at the 44-yard line, and they're going to go back to Sean Rutherford. Nope, it's going to be Arndt. Arndt is the quarterback. He'll continue in that role after relieving Rutherford in the first half. Arndt's going to put it in the air, and he completes a pass to Andy Erickson for 8 yards to the 47-yard line. Tackle made by Bruce Jones. Erickson, junior out of Austin.
Good throw and catch, and he has a lot better zip on the ball. Arndt is more accurate than Rutherford is. And you're noticing he doesn't waste much energy. When he sees a throw, that ball is coming out in a hurry.
Again, Coach Franchione saying at the start of the year he had plans to play both quarterbacks. It was all Rutherford playing well against Houston last week. It's been a combination of the two here tonight. Straight ahead, Terrence Franks on the carry as he's tackled in the open field by Will Smith. We're going to call Will Smith's name a lot, the Mike linebacker, shutting down the sophomore in that play. First down, though.
Coach Tumfield said, last week he was in on 12. He only showed like two tackles by himself, but he was in on 12 different tackles. This kid loves to run to the ball.
You can see him in the middle there, number 7 on the defense in white, standing at the 36-yard line. Nearest to us, towards the bottom of the screen, Will Smith from the 41. Long count by Arndt, and throws it away. Nobody there, just hurled it out of bounds. No one was within 15 yards, it seemed, to that one.
Smart play. I mean, he didn't get the intentional grounding because there were a receiver in the area, and the running back, Terrence Franks, was heading that way. But the play wasn't there. Texas Tech had smelled it out and was going to blow it up. So what does he do? Gets rid of the ball. That's what you need. Those type of plays allow you to have success the next time.
Second and 10 now. Just underway third quarter. Texas Tech leading 38-10. Dominating from the outset, but Texas State has played much better with Arndt at quarterback in relief for Rutherford. Rolling left and throwing, and it's almost picked off. Eugene Nebo had it, and he could have run a long way if he hauled it in.
you have to make the play when the opportunity is there. This play could have been a big impact to stop the flow of this offense. The corner right there, Eugene, was in a cover two, so he's playing a flat, and then he went backwards to make that play on the ball. Because there was only two receivers and four defenders on that side, that's a throw that shouldn't have happened, and you have to make that play. And Eugene Nebo did not make that play when he needed to.
All right, you've seen corners make bad plays. What's the case there? He didn't look it in?
He did not look it in, and he was thinking touchdown before catching.
Third and 10 now. Arndt's going to hand it off, and that is a play that is blown up in the backfield for loss. Guess who? Will Smith, number seven, shutting down Franks. It's interesting. We heard so much about Smith, and the talk is he feels like he has to make every tackle. I mean, it's a negative if he's not in on a play. He takes it personally.
You know, he reminds me a little bit of somebody we covered that's with the Seattle Seahawks right now, Bobby Wagner. A linebacker was at Utah State that just wanted to be in on every play. And this guy started as a freshman at 6'2", 210 pounds as an inside linebacker and finished at 234.
Relentless to the football. As Zach Robinson punts it away, hangs it in the air. And the fair catch called for and made by Austin Zuzulak, and the Red Raiders will have the football. First possession of the third quarter here in San Marcos when we come back. 28-point lead for Tuberville's gang. Thirty-8-10, Texas Tech in front of Texas State. The Bobcats fans were geared up for this one. Sellout crowd of 32,000, but the Red Raiders spoiling the party, and they have possession of the football at the 13-yard line on this series. Doege goes to work, completes to Kenny Williams, and he's shut down after a short gain out to the 16-yard line. Nice open field tackle made that time by Justin Iwuji, the junior safety. He's been very active.
Definitely been very active, and I think because they switched the scheme, when you're going against four wide receivers, you got to get more DBs in there to make plays.
Doege looking to top 300 yards again for the ninth time in his career. Second down, has time over the middle, wide open, Bell, and he's got running room. 40. Javon Bell across the 45 and knocked out of bounds. And no one was near Bell, who was in the clear in the flat. And the junior took it for big yardage, 31 yards.
That play worked because they caught them in a man under two deep. The DB on the left side got picked off, And so that allowed the receiver, Javon Bell, to be running wide open.
To the 47-yard line. Deggy looking underneath. Goes to the sideline. Catch by Williams, and he's knocked out of bounds near the line of scrimmage. Good play made that time by Chad Moncure, the sophomore weak side linebacker.
Now, the one thing I'm a little bit shocked about is they were so balanced last week. I'm curious at why right now they're not working on running the ball a little bit more.
Well, we talked about how they had balance in that, that first game, 47 passes, 46 runs. And they might get into that a little bit more as this game wears on. Deggy to the flat, catch made, and it's a first down grab by Alex Torres, who already has a touchdown catch, and that one to the 44-yard line, just shy of the first down.
Oh, that was a pretty throw right there. He just seriously zipped that ball on the outside shoulder low. Torres went down there with those big mitts and just snatched it up.
They really like Torres, a guy that was a starter in 10 games a year ago. Senior out of El Paso, third and one. Williams running right, big room, real estate. He's to the 20, and he's finally knocked down from behind at the 17-yard line. Jason McClain, the tackle. There is a flag on the play, and it looked like Williams might take that one to the house.
Yeah, and I think they may get him on a little horse collar, even though he let go. I think it's going to be a little horse collar. But look at Williams. He's hit it right there. And right there, you see the hand pull the jersey a little bit. Even though he let go, they're going to get him on the horse collar.
That's an automatic, right?
That's automatic. You got to protect the safety of the kids.
So they will tack it on at the end of that big run by Kenny Williams, and there is that running game. And they've got some weapons with Stevens and Williams, and we haven't seen much of Foster at all in the backfield.
Well, and what was really effective about that is they did it on third and one, and usually that's a tough part when you look at Kenny Williams' numbers there, especially that big run just added to it, is when you are able to line up in the spread, but when you have to bring it in and go for that run to be able to get it, and that's exactly what they did on a third and short. That's usually a snafu for the spread offense.
He'll stay in as a setback, standing next to Deggy. First and goal. Deggy over the middle, and is it Bell? It is, and it's a touchdown.
That's complete to Javon Bell. Touchdown, Texas Tech.
And that is five touchdown strikes for Deggy, and Bell has his first of the evening.
You see right here, he just gets him on a slant, man-to-man. These corners are getting beat off press coverage. He was in press coverage. You're looking at Daryl Morris right there, and he just gets beat on the slant route. When you're playing bump and run on the as a corner, you have to be upfield shoulder so you have a chance to make a play on the ball.
Bell missed the opener, team suspension. He has shown just like Darren Moore has after his suspension, and Buston's extra point makes it 45-10. Texas Tech, Deggy, a precision strike. Bell, the junior from Jacksonville, Florida, makes it 45-10. Red Raiders 45, Bobcats 10, early stages third quarter. Seth Doege with five touchdown passes. That ties his career record. He had five against New Mexico last year. Coach Tommy Tuberville said, expect a big game from Doege. Well, there are the numbers. It has been a big game, and his night is not yet done. Will they make a change at quarterback with that comfortable lead? Battle across the 15 on the return for Texas State. And he's upended at the 17-yard line. This kid is pretty impressive, though. Academic All-Big 12, O'Brien semifinalist last year. He is the all that and more.
Well, the biggest thing for me is he is going to graduate in December with his graduate degree.
Master's. How about that?
So it's like you got to wrap your brain around that, that in this span he's able to control the offense, and those classes are not easy. So I mean that's huge. But you see, that's why this kid's smart. What he's doing on the field, he does in the books as well.
Arndt stays out of quarterback meanwhile for Texas State. Play fake. Tyler Arndt rolling, throwing to the far sideline and incomplete.
That's a tough throw right there, to be on the far hash, naked bootleg out, and the receiver running a comeback route. That's a tough long throw to make on the move.
He was looking for Jafus Gaines, a redshirt freshman out of Houston. Obviously, for both schools, Texas heavy. You don't have to go far to find talent in this rich state for football.
No, and that's why all these schools, for the most part, are always competitive, because there's such a rich pool of players around here.
Arndt's going to run the option now. Pitches it to Tim Gay, and Gay is close to a first down across the 28-yard line.
Tim Gay on the carry.
Gay from Houston. And he's kind of a combo guy, speed and strength, behind Curry and Franks in the backfield.
Right, and Terrence Bullitt right there, same game type of situation
yards,
before. Had the
two.
Option, but somebody didn't come off, so he had to try to cover the quarterback and the running back, force the quarterback to pitch, and had to chase that play from behind. Those are the little assignment things that Art Coffin talked about that they were trying to make sure. So even though this game is out of hand and you know you're going to win, you still want to be able to play technically sound.
They marked him at the 26, third and two from there. Straight ahead, Gay, not going to get there. Shut down. Cody Davis filling the hole from the safety spot. Will Smith was in there as well. And they are so active. And when you see those defensive backs flying in there, that's a swarming D, and Art Kaufman's got to love what he's seeing.
Well, that was perfect. He had a third and short. He knew it was a run play. Mano y mano, who's going to get off the block and make the play? And the defense did what they needed to do, force a three and out, allow their offense to get back on the field.
Zuzulak should have a good opportunity standing back at the Red Raider 35-yard line. Zach Robinson gets the kick away from his 18, a wobbler. Zuzulek calling for a fair catch, and he makes it at the 26-yard line. At the start of the show, we talked about two guys that are familiar faces in college football. There's one of them, Dennis Francione.
First down, Texas Tech.
Fourth season at Texas State, 27th overall. And these two hooked up in the Iron Bowl. Tommy winning two out of the three as coach at Auburn, and Dennis has that win in 2001, and one of them was the blowout, and Dennis had that 31-7.
That's huge. I mean, that is a very big time game if you've ever been in Alabama. That's what people think about beginning of the year, but that's huge when you look at that score versus the other two.
Doege throws to the sideline, catch made by Bell, and he's bumped out of bounds after a first down grab at the 43-yard line, pickup of 15. That last win in that Iron Bowl, by the way, by Auburn over Alabama, started a streak of six straight wins by Auburn over Alabama, which is the longest streak in that rivalry. Just not very often you see a rivalry game like that go that long to one side.
Well, in that state, those kind of streaks get you fired.
You got to win that game, right?
You got to win that game.
Sadale Foster's in the backfield. He's going to flare out in a pass situation, and they throw it incomplete. Doege short hops him on the far side of the field.
First, we've seen a Foster in the backfield, number eight, a junior out of Riverside, California.
You know, they got a lot of kids from that Riverside Junior College on this team. I think what's nice about what Tuberville's trying to do, he's building depth. He said in order to play big boy football, you got to be able to go 2 to 3 deep at almost every position.
He says one concern depth-wise is on their offensive line. Here's Foster with a carry and a first down as he shows a burst of speed. And he takes it to the Bobcat side of the field to the 46-yard line. They have depth at running back with Foster when you can throw Stevens, Williams, and Foster out there.
And it's a three-headed monster. See, they're going no huddle right now. That's what Texas State needs to be doing as well to get on track. Because look what happens. When you go no huddle, you're catching people coming in and out. They're tired. And you can see right now, we talked about the running game. Foster, now they're starting to run the ball off of this no huddle just to start to switch some things up.
2 yards, second and eight.
You know, the no huddle can get you back on your heels quite a bit. We saw that a lot with Louisiana Tech over the last couple of years, very successful with it. But you better have your T's crossed and your I's dotted, because it's easy to turn it over if you try to rush too quickly and you don't have everything in line.
Exactly.
It's a dangerous situation if you're not careful.
Yeah, and you have to be careful. But I find for offenses that are struggling, it's the best way to get them going.
Here's Foster, a carry to the right side. He shut down right at the line of scrimmage. Good play made that time defensively. They haven't had much
up front. Tackled by number 91, Blake McCulloch.
But that was Blake McCulloch, the returning starter defensive tackle, a junior from Midland, Texas.
And it's third down.
Because even in the NFL, you'll notice a lot of teams do that. The Cardinals, when they struggle, they go to the two-minute, they call it the two-minute instead of the no huddle, and it seems to get their offense up and going.
Third down, eight from the Bobcats, 45. They back off on the blitz. Deggy looking downfield, completes the pass for a first down. That's hauled in by Darren Moore. They have not punted the entire evening, and they move the chains with that play.
Deggy's doing a good job of getting the ball around. When you look at what's going on here, look at the start point and how many plays it takes for them to score and the yards. It's just, it's huge. Because, especially this last one, on your own 13, six plays, 87 yards for a touchdown. That takes the life out of a defense.
Play fake, Deggy going down the sideline, and he has Bell again. One of his favorite targets tonight. Gets
pass
the foot down,
Bell.
And they'll mark him out of bounds at the 16-yard line, and they hurry up to the line of scrimmage.
What you're seeing right there is a corner route. The corners are getting all mixed up right now. Nobody's getting in the right spot. They're starting to get a little tired, and they're not making plays. Right now, everybody's lined up, bump and run. Man to man, we'll see what kind of pressure they put on them.
First down from the 15. Williams is back in at the running back. A delay handoff to Williams inside the 10, upended at the 5, keeps his feet churning, and he is, no indication yet.
Jimmy Williams into the end zone. Touchdown.
Is he in? He is. No indication, but he is into the end zone for the touchdown. It looked like he was going down. He landed on another player.
That's what the key is. He lands on somebody else. Don't be surprised to see it on SportsCenter tonight. Watch as he makes this contact, gets hit, spins up in the air. His knee does not, and his butt does not touch the ground. And because that did not happen, he continues on into the end zone for a touchdown.
And he's enjoying that. His first rushing touchdown this season. Had two last year in 10 games. And Kenny Williams, nice change of pace when you go Stevens and Williams. That's a good 1-2 punch. Extra point coming from Buston. And the kick is good.
The point after is good.
52-10, Texas Tech. First, it was a passing game. Deggy has over 300 yards. Now the running game. Kenny Williams keeps his feet up and finds the end zone.
Big night for the Red Raiders. Texas Tech 52-10. They have not had to punt the football the entire evening. Deggie with five touchdown passes. Williams with a touchdown run. And Texas Tech going to move the record to 2-0. Kramer Fife to kick it away. Fielded on the run at the 10-yard line and up to the 25 on the return. As Texas State
Jafus Gaines returned
that, the redshirt freshman from Houston. So if you're the Bobcats, you need to start looking ahead to conference season. You had a big road win at Houston, different story tonight. And Coach Franchione, I'm sure, knows this is a learning process. Disappointed, I'm sure, because it's in front of such a great crowd here. As they go back to Rutherford now, quarterback.
Well, you know, you got to get some kind of spark. I go back to, if I'm them, I go 2 minutes the rest of this quarter. I want to get my offense in the end zone a second time, maybe a third time. And so let my guys work on their blocking assignments and go some no huddle and just see if I can pick the pace of this game up and get my guys playing like I want them to play.
Sean Rutherford,
started the game, replaced by Arndt, who has led them to those 10 points. Back in,
no game,
carries the football on first down for a yard. He's a guy that was a two-time FCS Player of the Week last year, or a couple years ago, actually. He was at Blinn Junior College with head coach Brad Franchione, who's now an assistant coach under Dennis at Texas State. Going to keep it running left this time. Rutherford cuts it up. Nifty piece of running right there up to the 32-yard line.
Right now, what I'm seeing a little bit, I see a little firing off the ball. There's two things that needs to happen here. Texas State, like I said, has to put something together to get some points on the board to keep it going. But I think it's even more important for Texas Tech in this defense, because of what happened last year, to make sure even when you have a game like this where it's out of hand and you're winning, to keeping them under control and still forcing three and outs.
Well, and this is the stage, you know, you look ahead. You got Stephen F. Austin, you've got Nevada coming up, and then at New Mexico. You already know you can be competitive. You're facing a very good team from the Big 12 here. And it's Rutherford again. It's been the Rutherford show on third and two.
Rutherford again for a game of 2 yards.
This. It's going to be short of the first down at the 34, fourth and a yard coming
up. Fourth and one.
Now, right now, if you went for it, like I think they're going to do, it's fourth and short. You got nothing else to lose right now. Just work on what you have to work on. See if you can get these conversions. I think it's huge. And you can see the defense getting ready. It's like, hey, we got to get this. Fourth and short, we can make this work.
They're going to go with three backs. It's like the wishbone here on fourth and one. Reverse wishbone, and it's not going to get it done. They are shut down and will turn it over on downs as they handed the football off to Robert Lowe, a freshman, and he comes up short, and the Red Raiders have it.
I don't fault him for trying, but you can see right there, just more defenders in the hole than the offense can block. When they know exactly what you're going to do and where you're coming, it's all about who can beat you to the spot, and Texas Tech beat them to the spot.
A lot of Red Raiders fans in attendance here. Some ESPN 3 games, exclusive ESPN 3 games to check out next Saturday. We've seen Montana in the past, great FCS program. North Carolina State had a win over UConn today. That's a game to take a look at. There's a pass that's incomplete as Michael Brewer
pass is incomplete,
comes onto the scene replacing Seth Deege. But some games you want to keep an eye on that across the country that sometimes don't get the notoriety of
right
the big schools get.
And like you said, they're the good teams, and they play FBS schools tough. We've done a couple of these games where they've well, perfect example, last week, Eastern Washington knocking off Idaho.
Michael Brewer, the redshirt freshman, maybe the future at quarterback for Texas Tech, hands it off. And running hard is Eric Stevens, who's back into the game, and he rumbles for a first down inside the 25-yard line. Brewer is an exciting prospect. He played just the fourth quarter last week against Northwestern State, 10 of 13, a couple touchdown passes. Destined to be a quarterback, Jay.
It's amazing when you look at his bio. His dad, Robert, quarterback at Texas. Grandpa, Charlie, quarterback at Texas. Uncle, quarterback at Texas. Great uncles, quarterbacks at Texas Tech and Oklahoma. And he's a quarterback at Texas Tech. Here's a handoff to the right side, and it's Stevens. Flags thrown everywhere as he's close to a first down at the 14-yard line. I mean, he had no choice. He had to be a quarterback at a big-time school, right?
Well, unless he wanted to start to play baseball or something. It's like, he probably said, hey, I want to play receiver. They looked at him like, what? No, I want to play running back. Like, what? No, you're a quarterback, son. That's what you do. And this kid, you can tell by his demeanor, the way he steps in. They said in spring practice, he had a great spring practice. And you saw what happened last week. Like you said, going 10 of 13, a couple of touchdowns. That's 76% completion. I mean, that's huge to step into a game and do that. So I think the kid's going to be great.
Penalty marked off against the Red Raiders. They'll march him back to the 37. A chop block, so it's first down and 23 now at the 37. Brewer, delay handoff. Stevens is met in the hole. Nothing doing as Brian Lilly, Sam linebacker. It's Williams on the carry, and Lilly met him in the hole. Good play
Williams
from
the carry.
Four-year Sam linebacker. Getting back to Brewer, you know, he was rated a top 50 overall recruit in Texas, which is one thing, but also played at Lake Travis High School, four consecutive state titles. That's a great program.
That's dominance right there, especially when you're talking about the state of Texas, to do that four times.
From the gun, second and 23. Yeah. Brewer running away from pressure, throws on the run downfield, and it is caught, almost caught and almost intercepted. Hung it up there for Tyson Williams. And that ball was up for grabs.
Look at how Brewer moves around this pocket. Nothing's there, gets out, keeps both hands on the ball, which is huge. And then puts that ball up there to give his receiver a chance to make the play. I'd like to see it more towards the sideline where his receiver was. But still, all in all, you've seen the athletic ability and what he's able to do when the play breaks down.
Jason McClain on the coverage there. Third down and 23. Four receivers, three, top of the screen. They'll run it with a delay. And it's Sadale Foster, and he's tackled by Morris at the 34-yard line. So fourth down coming up. Let's see what they opt to do here with this huge advantage.
Brings up fourth down.
Well, in this type of situation, you need to try the very long field goal or you punt it.
It's going to be the kick. It's going to be a field goal here. They're going to bring Ryan Buston out. He's already connected tonight. This will be a 50-yard attempt. Made all three of his kicks last week. Perfect 4-for-4 on the year. And the left footer from Kilgore, Texas will try to add to the lead as we wrap up this third quarter. Snap, a good one. Kick on the way. Does it have enough leg? It is good from 50. Ryan Buston. And the highlights continue for the Red Raiders.
That kick needed a 5-hour energy drink to get over the post. I mean, it just barely leaked over. I'm like, it's not going to make it. That's not going to make it. That just got over.
That is about as good as it gets for a kicker. Of course, winning the game is the ultimate, but a 50-yarder. His career long. He spent a year at Kilgore Junior College in Texas from Kilgore. And he is perfect on field goals this season. 5-for-5, three quarters in the books in San Marcos. 55-10. Texas Tech making it look easy against Texas State.
55-10, Texas Tech rolling as we open up this fourth quarter. Buston with a 50-yard field goal to add the lead. 8 of 9 possessions for Tommy Tuberville's team as they have dominated in every facet. Andrew Bowman, the new kickoff specialist, to kick this one away from the 35-yard line. Of course, the new rules now in college football, kicking off from the 35. And we saw a lot of touchbacks last week, not so this week. The return by Benjamin Ijah to the 23-yard line. What do you think of the rule? 35-yard line now kicking it off, and then the touchback comes out to the 25.
I understand why they're doing it, and I think it's good because they want to eliminate some of these hard contacts. And I think for offenses, it's nice. If you let it go in the end zone, you're going to come out to the 25. That's 5 more yards you gain. I think the hard part for the big guys, I played with somebody like Ron Wolfley and these guys that are used to running a good 10, 12 yards back and being wedge busters. So they've taken that piece out of the game.
The guys that like contact don't like it, huh?
Yeah.
They like to get in there and mix it up. They don't get as many opportunities. Here's Rutherford at quarterback. Slings it left side. Catch made by Ijah. And he has made his presence felt tonight. Pickup of 11 to the 34-yard line.
First down,
Benjamin Ijah from Southwestern College, from San Diego originally. Trey Porter on the tackle.
Well, they're getting to see, some of these kids are stepping in and getting some more playing time, and I think they'll be okay. It's just going to take some time. This program has went through a process. It's growing. As they get more recruits, being now that they're FBS, I can see this team getting much better.
Here's a handoff, fake handoff, and a keeper by Rutherford, and he churns out a yard, and that's it.
No gain on the play.
They'll say right at the line of scrimmage, as Texas Tech's pursuit has been awesome all evening long. That time, Pete Robertson in on the play.
Well, speed, that's what they wanted to do. They said this defense is about speed and aggressiveness to the ball, and that's exactly what Texas Tech has been doing this entire game, and they did it the first game. And I think that was the big sore spot on this team last year, why they went 5-7, and I think this is going to be a big turnaround for them.
Rutherford setting up the screen, caught by Battle, flag is thrown, and Battle's tackled at the 41-yard line, 3 yards shy of the first down. Jarvis Phillips on the tackle, but hold on.
On the offense, 5 players in the backfield, 5-yard penalty, second down.
Now, these are when penalties happen at this point in time in the game. It's lack of concentration. You see right there, Coach Francione is going to be a little upset about some of these types of penalties. They should not be happening. And I think he has to look at this and say, he told us, I always look at what I got, and I make play, and I go to what I got. And so he did this pistol-type offense with the players he got. As he's able to continue to bring in the type of players he wants, you can see the system adjusting.
Tries to fit the personnel into the right spot. Rutherford going deep downfield and incomplete. Intended down there.
Pass is incomplete, intended for number 80, Japhus Gaines.
That was Japhus Gaines, who had a chance at it on the near sideline.
Nice throw. Nice throw. He put it in a spot, and he has to come up with that throw, I think. And it gave his quarterback time on the sideline, but that's the catch, I think, Gaines could have made. Just one more step, lay out a little more.
So third and 14 now. It's a process building the program. Francione saying that their goal is a bowl game this year. This obviously a setback, but you have the win against Houston. Be interesting to see how they stack up in the Western Athletic Conference.
Timeout, Texas Tech.
Texas Tech with a timeout now. It's a league, the WAC, that has two pretty good programs in Louisiana Tech and Utah State. Utah State showed that with a win against Utah last night. 13:08 to go. Texas Tech well on their way to a 2-0 record, up by 45. Texas Tech up by 45 points with 13:08 to go here at Bobcat Stadium, the newly renovated Bobcat Stadium in San Marcos. It's been a disappointing evening for Texas State, facing a third and long. They'll run the draw play, and that's not going to get it done. On the carry that time,
Robert Lowe, the ball carry.
Well short of the first down, setting up a fourth down and 12. That's a play that just sets up the punt.
Just sets up the punt. And right now, it's third and forever. When you have third and forever, all you can hope for is a busted play or a pass interference, and that wasn't going to happen. So you do the smart thing, a draw.
Zach Robinson from his 24, and he nails a beauty. Spiraling kick, Zuzulak at the 13. Zuzulak up to the 24-yard line, and that's where the Red Raiders will have the football.
Now, I've noticed something the past two punts, that if they're paying attention, if Coach Francione's son is who's the special teams guy, they've cleared out the middle as this has happened. So if you want to do a fake punt,
after the play was over,
on the kicking team, Jordan Norfleet, the guilty party for Texas State.
Yeah, not smart. But so what happens is other teams watch this tape too, and when they see those type of things happen, they're going to take advantage of it. And at this point, I would try something like that just based on the last two things, that last two punts I saw.
So we get to see Michael Brewer again, who is a guy that comes from a football family, a quarterback football family. And he's a guy that they believe can be a dual threat. Good speed, excellent arm, and about the same size as Deggie. Throws it to the left side, and the catch is made. And it's hauled in by Jakeem Grant, good enough for a first down to the 49.
Gotta love the little receiver making his living across the middle of the field where usually the big boys hang out. That's been a good thing, and especially, you know, I was a small defensive back, so I know what it's like to be small around these big guys, to have no fear and get up there in the middle.
Small is one thing, but 5'6 and 163, that's pint-sized. Here's Sedale Foster with a catch out of the backfield, trying the other side of the field. Sidesteps one man and goes down at the 47 of Texas State. And it'll set up a second and seven from there.
Now, we talked about the balance and run and pass, but understand in this spread offense, that little bubble screen is a form of the run, extension of it. Think of Joe Montana and the West Coast offense. The slants and outs were a form of run.
4-yard pickup there as we near the 11-minute mark. Texas Tech coming off a disappointing season last year, 5-7. Hit hard by injuries. 16 players with surgery last year. Brewer rolling left, throws, and a beauty, a strike for a first down. And that's Darren Moore out of bounds to the 24-yard line. That shows the ability on the move of Brewer.
Trey, not only does it show the ability, it shows his arm strength. Look at him move around the pocket, both hands on the ball again, move around, nothing's there. He takes his hand off his shoulder, and look at, on the move, throwing to the sideline, soap on a rope. That is the kind of throw that you'd like out of your young quarterback. Nice tight spiral, puts it towards the sideline while his receiver can get it.
Now they'll run it with Sedale Foster straight ahead, and he keeps the legs turning, running hard. Foster with the first down inside the 13-yard line.
He's another small guy, 5'7", but he has a little bit more girth to him. He's 187. So the hard part with these little guys, especially when they get bigger like that, think of Maurice Jones-Drew. They're hard to break down because they're so low to the ground.
And they're going to hurry up here. Foster's just 5'7", 187. He's looking to, he's vying for more playing time behind Stevens and Williams. Trying to impress Brewer with the pass, and it's caught by Zuzulek inside the two, and he has a first down just shy of the goal line at the 1-yard line. Austin Zuzulek, last year 13 catches. He's primarily their punt return guy. Nice catch on a short play.
Just gets the ball out. Now watch Zuzulek put his head down and just try to drive. He's trying to drive himself in there. Good team tackle there by Texas State. surrounding him, not wanting him to get into the end zone.
Xavier Daniels, a free safety with the stop, but it's first and goal for the Red Raiders, looking to eclipse the 60-point mark in this one. Foster in the backfield behind Brewer. Brewer for the corner, incomplete. Tried to lob it up for Derek Edwards there.
Yeah, and that was the situation. Derek Edwards had to turn himself into the DB because of where the ball was thrown. There was miscommunication between the two. Brewer thought he was going to do the outside release to the corner of the end zone, and he released inside.
Second and goal now. Again, Foster standing a couple yards behind Brewer. One receiver split left. Handoff Foster. Hit in the backfield and dropped for a loss. And that's Justin Iwiji. He has been sensational from the safety spot.
Well, he came in right there. That's the kind of play you got to have out of your safety. He's had a couple balls go through his hands. So to get in there and make a big play for a tackle for loss in the backfield, I think that's huge. Give the defense a little bit of breathing room to where they could try to get a force here and maybe force a field goal.
He's a junior from Carrollton, Texas, part-time starter a year ago. Now it's third and goal from the five-yard line. Four receivers this time, three to the left. Brewer looking left, back of the end zone incomplete. Throws it away, and it's fourth down.
That was a smart throw. The defense got the right play. They backed off. They knew the slants were coming. And what does Brewer do? The smart thing. Even though he had a big receiver, he didn't try to force it in there. He just threw it over. He said, you know what? We got 3 points. Let's just take 3 points. Watch this. As he's reading it, he sees where he wants to go. Nothing's there. Just throws it high. Let me just get rid of it. Take my 3 points and get off the field.
He's a competitor, though. You can see his frustration when he comes off the field. He is a perfectionist, no doubt about it.
Right, but that's a smart thing. He said, you know what? This is the best play. The best play is to throw it away.
Here's Ryan Buston. He's already connected from 50, and he's now 3 for 3 on the evening in field goals as he adds to the Red Raiders lead. 8:32 to go. Texas Tech gets three more. Now up 58-10 here at Red Raiders 58-10 with 8:32 to go here in San Marcos, Texas. Well, this is a Texas Tech team coming off a disappointing 5-7 season. Picked 9th out of 10 teams in the preseason Big 12 poll by the media. They're not going to finish 9th, are they?
Well, I don't think they're going to finish 9th. And when you look at some of these things, I always ask myself, who are these people that actually picked this? I honestly feel when they look at things like this, they don't really watch teams, because you can't base 1 year to the next year. You have to look at what they did to improve themselves in that offseason.
A lot of questions for Baylor without RG3, obviously. And here's a return, and a good return by Javis Gaines for Texas State out to the 34-yard line. You've got Kansas State improved with Bill Snyder, obviously. Iowa State bowl game. No longer Missouri and A&M, but when you add West Virginia and TCU to the Big 12, what a powerhouse conference. I mean, West Virginia might be the best of the bunch.
And you know, Coach Francione even brought up the fact that he felt that they could be ranked number one in the nation just because he's
West Virginia, because
he's familiar with their program and what they've done. So they got just stronger. I think, in essence, I feel they got two better teams coming in.
TCU has been a powerhouse last few years, now trying to make a dent in the Big 12 this year. That carry on that last play by Dexter Amade, a junior from Rowlett, Texas. Here's a look at the Big 12 teams ranked. And there's the Frogs from Fort Worth. But Oklahoma, West Virginia, Texas still a question mark. How good can they be?
You know, and they still got the couple quarterback situation that they're working out. We're using two different guys. So it's going to be a little bit tell to see what happens when the games get tougher competition. But I think they'll be ready.
Arndt, a little swing pass. And it's into the hands of Robert Lowe, the freshman running back, and he's up to the 41-yard line.
Pass complete to Robert Lowe.
TCU rolling to a victory, it appears, today. With it up 56-0 last we checked. It's in the fourth quarter. Big 12 didn't lose a game in week one. And you got to think they're in the national championship hunt again. If it's not Oklahoma and West Virginia, I think it'd be a surprise, but probably one of those two.
Yeah, one of those two seem to be the front runners. And they bring back a lot of people from the year before, and those teams got to bowl games and were in contention. So they're definitely two front runners, but you know, you got to line up and play it every week. You never know what's going to happen from week to week.
No question. And we've seen FCS over FBS upsets. And how about Texas State beating Houston last week? There's a completion for Arndt that moves the chains. Gets it into the hands of his tight end, Bradley Miller, 6'5 target from Sealy, Texas, with a nice grab.
And, you know, that wasn't the only game that happened like that. When you look at the first week, they always say the first week and the second week is good for upsets, because look what Ohio did going into Happy Valley and beating Penn State. And people realize, it shouldn't have happened. These smaller schools have just as much talent as the bigger schools, just not as deep.
Not as many numbers.
That's the only thing.
Penn State lost today 17-16 to West Virginia, by the way. And there's Virginia, I should say. 17-16 is Arndt's pass.
He's
off target there. But, you know, we've seen it. You know, Eastern Washington has a quarterback, Kyle Padrone, who is at SMU. He's an FBS-type quarterback, and they almost knocked off Washington State today after beating Idaho a week before.
Right, and even the Badger. Remember, there was talk that from LSU, he was going to end up going to a smaller school to try to play this year, then he changed his mind. So these schools are very competitive. It's just the difference is they're not deep like all the big schools.
Arndt, quick strike pass over the middle, caught by Dashe Milburn. And he's close to a first down at the 41-yard line. The sophomore from League City, Texas, back up a year ago.
Good zip right there. Watch Arndt just put that right in front, allows this guy to catch it, holds on to the ball. That's a nice hit there. And to be able to hold on to the ball, that's a good play.
As a defensive back, you want to let that receiver know that, you know, you're coming into my area, right?
Well, that's when you play with guys like Ronnie Lott. And yeah, you want them to know. That's for sure.
Message delivered. Arndt with a deep drop. He's pressured, and he throws it away. Pressure coming that time from Pete Robertson, the redshirt freshman right end from the Red Raiders.
Arndt does the right thing. He knows he's not as fast as Rutherford is. Gets outside the pocket, gets the ball out of his hand. They live to do another play. These are the kind of things that when the game's out of hand, coaches are watching. They want to see if the kids are making the right reads, making the right decisions so that their team has an opportunity to get in the end zone.
And you got to think, when you look ahead now, as you see Arndt's numbers, that he has done a better job than Rutherford and would probably have the edge to be the starter next week, right?
I think so, but I think he's going to still stick with switching quarterbacks. Whoever's having the hot hand is going to be the one that's going to be there, but that's the big thing about it. I like how he's played, even though some of these passes were bad throws by him, thrown away. I don't call those bad throws, but some of the receivers dropping. I think overall he's played much better.
Tim Hawkins with that grab to the 32, sets up a third and one for that point for the Bobcats. It'll be a tough venture into the WAC this year. They've got Stephen F. Austin, then conference play, Nevada, at New Mexico, Idaho, at San Jose State, and then back-to-back, two tough games against potential bowl teams at Utah State and Louisiana Tech. Third down and a yard. Play fake. Down the middle of the field, and it's picked off. Picked off by Texas Tech's Jeremy Reynolds. He's to the 40. Reynolds keeping his feet alive, and he's finally down at midfield. So Reynolds picks off Arndt.
By number 23, Jeremy Reynolds.
And there is a flag on the field.
Reynolds did an exceptional job of hiding on the backside. Arndt did not see him at all, and he just slid right in there, kind of like what happened.
Block in the back. Defense number 27. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
And Zach Winbush, the linebacker, but the Red Raiders do have the football.
That's the same situation that early Cody Davis getting that 88-yard interception for a touchdown. Same type of thing. Didn't see the guy come from the backside. Slides right on in there. Picks that ball off and gets positive yards to help the defense out.
Been a tough night for Texas State fans. They had high hopes heading into this one after winning on the road at Houston last week, but it's been all Red Raiders, up by 48 points with 4:23 to go. Michael Brewer stays in at quarterback in relief of Seth Doege. Five touchdown passes for Doege. The dominating effort. Brewer catch by Marquez, and he's knocked down at the 25-yard line. David Mims on the play.
Pass complete to
Marquez. Key in the return game, but has had to step up with Out Eric Ward on the field, banged up in practice. He's a normal receiver in that spot on the field.
And he seems to do fine because they spread it around so much. You can lose one guy, but you have enough depth, what Tuberville likes, and they're able to continue on.
They hope that's not serious as Foster takes it up to the 30 for a first down. They hope it's not serious with Ward. An all Big 12 receiver, Biletnikoff Award candidate, didn't have him tonight.
Well, and that's the thing about it, I think, because they're so deep with so many guys and what they do, that if they miss one guy, even if they miss two guys, we saw tonight the younger ones can step in and play. I'll never forget Fitz Shermer was the defense coordinator I had when I was with the Cardinals a couple years. His thing was, I don't have 11 starters and 11 backups. I have 22 starters. And so that's the mindset you got to take. You're always one play away.
Brewer setting up a screen. And that's shut down pretty effectively. Catch by Jordan Davis for a short gain. Davis had that play that was reviewed by the officials that was ruled a catch earlier in the game. As we near the 3-minute mark here, Texas Tech looking ahead. They get New Mexico at home. Then they start conference play with a road trip to Iowa State, which won't be easy.
You know, and I think that's the telltale. This is, quote unquote, the preseason with these type of games that get scheduled. And you're trying to work some things out to get ready for your conference play.
And there's a pass play that's complete into the hands of Tyson Williams, and he has a first down, a big gain up to the 46-yard line. Let's look at that Red Raider schedule. New Mexico, then the bye, which helps prior to conference season.
Right, and you can see that they're setting it up. They want to go through the preseason, work through some things, and then get into the meat of their schedule where they go through their conference and one by one to see who they can take off. You can see their tough games. They'll come back to back, Oklahoma and West Virginia.
They get them at home, though.
They get them at home, but those are still two tough games back to back.
Boy, it is quite a tough stretch in the Big 12 these days, trying to win any football game.
Well, and think of it this way, too. They beat Oklahoma last year in Oklahoma, snapping the streak, 39-game win streak. So I can guarantee you the Sooners are going to come in with a little chip on their shoulder, having something to prove.
Yeah, that was their highlight. Then, yeah, they lost to Iowa State 41-7 the next game. 66-6 to Oklahoma State. First losing season in 16 years. They've been a model of consistency at Texas Tech. Prior to last year, very disappointing. Last year, comfortable win here as Foster's getting some work as he takes it down to the 33-yard line.
Foster on the carry.
The questions, though, have been year in and year out about their defense. Tommy Tuberville bringing Art Kaufman in as defensive coordinator. And at least, you know, I know it's early season, but there have been some good signs for the first two games.
And I think the good signs are showing that the kids are understanding what they want to do, giving themselves the name, the chain gang, trying to make sure that the links stay strong together. They understand the concept of defense, of playing as a single unit every snap of the game. And, you know, they had some tough times. I'll give you a perfect example. They had four different coordinators in the past 4 years. Let's look at the NFL. Alex Smith, in his first 7 years in the NFL, had seven different offensive coordinators. Everybody was saying he was a bust, he was a bust, he was a bust. Well, it's hard to have a different system every year and to be effective. So when you can bring some consistency and kind of, I don't like the word dumb it down, but make it basic so the guys can react, you get a lot better play.
You don't think on defense, right? React. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, you want to react. You want to think before the play is snapped. After that, you want to react.
There's a little slant pattern. Nice play. Brewer hooking up with Derek Edwards for a first down inside the 20-yard line. Final 35 seconds here as Texas Tech's going to roll on to the victory here, move to 2-0, and gear up for a home date against New Mexico. 7-hour drive from Lubbock to San Marcos. I know some of those fans made that trip here. They've got some loyal fans in West Texas.
Well, I think Texas overall has some great fans. They travel around. Football is definitely king around here, and you can see it by how people show up to the games and how they travel to follow their teams. And I think it's awesome. I think this game shows the fact that no matter who you're playing in Texas, people are going to pack the stadium.
So 58-10 the final. For Jay Taylor, I'm Trey Bender saying so long from San Marcos, Texas. Texas Tech 58, Texas State 10. To watch this entire game on replay, as well as other games on our family of ESPN networks, log on to WatchESPN.com or download the Watch ESPN app. Thanks, everybody, for watching. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports.